Hitter tonight for Detroit, batting second, Bill Madlock. In left field, batting third will be Kirk Gibson. The fourth hitter playing shortstop, Alan Trammell. Batting fifth, playing right field, Larry Herndon. In center field, batting sixth, Chet Lemon. The first baseman and seventh hitter, Darrell Evans. Batting eighth, playing third base, Tommy Brookins. Catching and batting ninth, Mike Heath.
That's the batting order for the Detroit Tigers, who try to draw even with a victory here tonight. Defensively, a considerably different look than we saw last night. Cecil Fielder starts at first base. Handling the second base chores is Nelson Liriano for Toronto. And at the shortstop position is Manny Lee. Over at third base, Garth Orge will get the call. In the outfield, George Bell returns in left. Lloyd Mosby is back in center. And replacing Rick Leach in right is Jesse Barfield. And we'll also have a new catcher for the Jays tonight, Charlie Moore. And on the mound is the veteran, Jimmy Key.
Jimmy Key is 17-6 with a 2.78 earned run average. His 34th appearance, he's pitched 239 and a third innings, given up 74 earned runs, 22 home runs. He's walked 61, he struck out 149. Has excellent control, fastball, curveball, and a slider.
Key has been hot. He has won eight straight since the 11th of July. He leads the American League with a 2.78 earned run average. Whitaker, Madlock, and Gibson will face him to open things up, and a base hit to left field for Lou Whitaker. Well, Lou jumps on the first pitch and lines it to left field, and the Tigers have a runner with Bill Madlock coming up.
First pitch by Key is up in the strike zone in the outside part of the plate. Lou Whitaker's been going more and more to left field and center field and getting more hits. Line drive out of the outstretched arms of Manny Lee. Bill Madlock batting second.
Madlock greeted as expected following the collision with Tony Fernandez last night. He has been the big story so far in Toronto. Madlock takes a breaking pitch low for a ball. Bill is the designated hitter. He was forced to leave the game last night. He took a foot in the chest in that collision and was having some difficulty breathing. It's outside for a ball. 2-0.
Very unfortunate. The shortstop Fernandez was hurt, broke his elbow. They have more technical terms than that, but that's just about that's bad enough. It was unfortunate. If he hadn't been hurt, nothing would have been said. But because he did get hurt and he's out for the season, a lot of accusations and implications, and what you have to do is go down and break up that double play, and it's the shortstop, second baseman, they just have to get out of the way, and Fernandez just didn't, and unfortunately landed on a hard surface at the area of the base there, and it broke his elbow.
Count is 2 balls and a strike to Madlock, and he fouls it back. The sliding area at each base is surrounded by tubifores, and it was on that tubifore that Fernandez landed right there. You can see it's covered with the AstroTurf, but that doesn't take any of the shock away. And he landed on that, and that's what caused the fracture. And he's out for the season. Underwent a couple of hours of surgery last night. Still hospitalized. Should be out in a couple of days. 2-2 the count to Bill Madlock. And he got him on strikes. Madlock had some comments about the incident last night.
First of all, I don't know why it's such a big deal. I guess if it won this time of the season, wasn't the two teams playing. I mean, this is the way I played all the time. The guys in the National League know I come in, you know, to try to keep from getting out. We end up scoring two runs. The main thing about that slide was to get us an extra out, and the extra out got us two runs. It wasn't a slide that hurt him. It was the wood around second base did it. He came down on his elbow on that, and I had nothing to do with that.
Lou Whitaker is at first base, one out. Kirk Gibson is the batter. He swings and misses. Ernie Witt, who was the catcher last night, had an interesting comment. He said, Madlock did it just exactly the way I would do it in a double play situation. I'd go after the shortstop or the second baseman. The only difference is that I'm a little slower, and they're usually gone by the time I get there.
You can't get there in time.
Two strikes to Gibson. lot of folks from the state of Michigan. We appreciate the folks who made up the pass signs that are moving them around the ballpark tonight. When we get a chance, we'll show you something that is doubtful you've ever seen before. We haven't. At Exhibition Stadium, the stands on the left field side go the length of what is a football field here, and usually they go down to about the 50-yard line. They're all the way down to the other end zone tonight. Here's a two-strike pitch to Gibby. It's low and away.
I hope they brought portable radios, because a baseball game out there is a rumor. It's a it might take two innings to get information out there. It's a long, long ways. And they have to look over a fence, the center field and right field fence.
1-2 delivery. One on. Got him on strikes. There are two out, and Alan Trammell will be the batter.
Key throwing the breaking ball on the outside part of the plate, and there's another big deep cutter. Kirk is pulling off it just a little bit, but that's a nasty pitch. That ball started on the inside part of the plate, ended out on the outside corner.
So Jimmy Key, after allowing the base hit to Lou Whitaker to open the game, has struck out Madlock and Gibson, and he'll face Alan Trammell. Trammell with a 3.41 average, 27 homers, and 101 RBIs. George Bell deep for him in left field, and Lloyd Mosby around toward left center. Cecil Fielder holding with a runner at first. Lou Whitaker, who hit the game's first pitch to left for a base hit. Inside for a ball. 1-0 to Alan Trammell. Whitaker taking his lead with two out. And the pitch from Key is lined deep to left field. Bell going over at the warning track and makes the catch. Well, the Tigers are out in the opening inning. No runs, one hit, no errors, one left. We'll go to the bottom of the first inning. There's no score in Toronto. Tigers look like they might make a run in the early part of this ball game, but Jimmy Key got the side without any further damage following Whitaker's base hit. Now here's the batting order that Jimmy Williams has put together to face Frank Tanana.
Leading off, playing second base, Nelson Lariano. Batting second, playing center field, Lloyd Mosby. Designated hitter tonight for the Jays. Batting third, Juan Beniquez. The left fielder and fourth hitter, George Bell. Batting fifth, playing first base, Cecil Fielder. The right fielder at batting sixth, Jesse Barfield. Playing third base and batting seventh will be Garth Orr. The eighth hitter and shortstop is Manny Lee. Catching and batting ninth, Charlie Moore.
That's the batting order for the division-leading Toronto Blue Jays, who have a game-and-a-half lead over the Detroit Tigers starting tonight's play. Darrell Evans is the first baseman for Detroit this evening. Handling the second base chores is Lou Whitaker. Over at shortstop for Detroit is Alan Trammell, and returning to the hot corner this evening is Tom Brookins. In the outfield, left is played by Kirk Gibson. In center field for Detroit is Chet Lemon, and handling the right field duties is Larry Herndon. Doing the catching again this evening is Mike Heath, and on the mound making his 32nd start, looking for his 14th win, is Frank Tanana.
Frank is 13-10 with a 4.35 earned run average. He's pitched 194 and two-thirds innings, given up 94 earned runs, 26 home runs. He's walked 51. He struck out 132. Frank relies on three speeds, curveballs. He throws slow, slower, and slowest. Tries to set up the hitters, get him looking for it. He also has a changeup that acts a little like a screwball, more a screwball than a changeup, and then slip the fastball on the inside part of the plate if he can.
Nelson Lariano will lead it off for the Blue Jays. He'll be followed by Lloyd Mosby and Juan Beniquez. First pitch from Tanana is hit off the end of the bat, rolls it to first, grabbed there by Evans, and one pitch, and there's one out. It'll bring up Lloyd Mosby. Evans had a great night with a glove last night. Didn't do so well with a bat, but he played nearly flawlessly. He had trouble handling a blast hit by Liriano that started the third run, third inning uprising that led to four runs. Lloyd Mosby will be the batter. Mosby with a 279 average, 24 homers, 93 RBIs.
Lloyd had a big year last year, 21 home runs, 86 RBIs. He's topped all those this year.
One out, nobody on, the Blue Jay first. Slow curve is in for a strike. Tanana has not won since the 11th of August when he beat the Chicago White Sox. Since then, he's 0-3 in seven starts. That misses low and away, 1-1. But he has made two starts against the Blue Jays this season. He beat them 3-2 here at Exhibition Stadium on the 17th and then shut them out at Detroit. Ground ball, right side, taken by Evans, tossed to Tanana, two are out. Tanana shut him out on five hits at Tiger Stadium on the 22nd of June. Both victories came over Jim Clancy. Juan Benitez, who did not play in last night's game, will be the batter. Benitez is the designated hitter, batting 267 overall since coming to Toronto, 355 this season. He's been around a while.
Juan has. He's a journeyman utility infielder outfield. He can play a little first and third if you have to put him over there. Plays the outfield. Won't embarrass you at all. Can get the job done. Not a great outfielder, but good enough. Pretty good hitter. Hits the ball straight away with some power.
There's a foul fly down the right field line into the seats. Benitez came from Kansas City for Luis Aquino on the 14th of July. At the time, he was batting 236 with Kansas City. One ball, one strike to Juan Benitez. The pitch from Tanana is a little bit low. That's Jim McKeon working the plate tonight. Tim McClellan is the umpire at first. John Schulock is at second. And Ken Kaiser is the umpire at third base. Here's the 2-1 delivery. Line to left field. Kirk Gibson is there and makes the catch. And the side is up and down in order in the first inning. For Toronto, no runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left. Tanana talking with the home plate umpire, Jim McKeon, as he heads to the dugout in the scoreless ball game.
Would you choose hamburger A, a Wendy's hamburger made with fresh beef, or hamburger B made with beef that's been frozen?
B. Phenomenal investment potential in frozen beef. Think about it. The other guy's paying top dollar for fresh. I snatch up this baby when nobody else will touch it.
But isn't fresh better?
That's the beauty. First thing you know, you gotta run on fresh beef. Supplies dry up. Bingo. I got frozen. I'm sitting on a gold mine.
Most people like the taste of hamburgers made with fresh beef, like Wendy's, the best burgers in the business.
We do more for you.
You couldn't tie me to a desk. You know, one thing I've learned is to treat every piece of furniture like it's my own. And that's a fact. I'm amazed that more people don't realize that we set up and deliver for free. And we do. I don't just deliver furniture. I deliver on a promise.
Harry LeBlanc. One more reason why.
We do more for you at an Art Van Furniture store.
Guests on Tiger Baseball will receive a gift from the 30 Wicks Lumber Centers serving you throughout the state of Michigan. Wicks has all it takes to build all you need. Wicks Lumber. And a gift from Casio, makers of the popular TV 400, a 2-inch color handheld TV with built-in speaker and rod antenna. Casio, a world leader in consumer electronics.
We talked with the manager of the Blue Jays earlier, Jimmy Williams, and asked him about the importance of last night's opening series victory.
Well, I think it's important to try and win the first game of any series, but, you know, with X number of games to go, I think it's a lift. I really do. It's a psychological lift. Two good clubs competing against each other, and we know what separates each other, and we've got six more with each other, plus they have four with Baltimore, and we have three with Milwaukee, but every game is vitally important right now.
I guess all 162 are important. There just seems to be more emphasis placed on the games down the stretch drive.
Well, you always like to win the first one. That way you can't be shut out and be swept, that's for sure. But if you lose the next three, the first one wasn't all that big. It just, it just depends on the outcome of the four-game set. Ends up 2-2, nobody won, nobody lost. 3-1, it hurts a little, but the team that loses the three, but you still have three games the end of the season to recover. So just don't get swept, that's the key.
Larry Herndon fouls the pitch back, and Jim Key is ahead 0-2. It'll be Herndon, Lemon, and Evans facing Jimmy Key here in the second inning. Lou Whitaker started the ball game with a single to left field on the first pitch, but Key fanned Badlock and Gibson and got Alan Trammell on a drive to rather deep left, sending George Bell back to the wall. Key has a strikeout pitch going. He gets Herndon. He is fan three.
Pitch seems to fool Larry Herndon. It's a fastball, and he just throws it by Larry. I think he had Larry set up looking for some off-speed pitches. Larry swung right through that ball, and that is an area that Larry normally hits the ball pretty hard. Good low fastball hitter.
Good look at Jimmy Key, who is going for a club record 18th victory here tonight. Lemon rips it up the alley to left center field. This will be a one hopper off the wall. Chester heads for second and will stop there with a two bagger. Chip Lemon with the Tigers' second hit of the night. A solid double up the alley, and it'll bring up Darrell Evans with a chance to drive home the game's first run.
Chet's been swinging the bat a lot better the last week, and there's a line shot. You see Chet stay right on his ball. It's right in the middle of the plate. Chet gets right on it and hits a line drive. Short hops the fence for an easy double.
Chet Lemon at second base with his 29th two-bagger of the year. And Darrell Evans, who was hitless last night, has a chance to put the Tigers on the scoreboard early. One out. And the pitch to Evans is in for a strike. Jimmy Key is currently tied with Doyle Alexander and Dave Steve with 17 victories, which represents a club record. Breaking pitch, lifted to left. That'll drop in for a base hit. Lemon is being waved home. Here comes Bell's throw. It's off target. He scores, and Evans goes to second base. Tigers lead 1-0. For the second straight night, a terrible throw from George Bell, and the Tigers wind up scoring a run easily. And Evans picks up his 95th RBI of the year to put the Tigers in front.
This is kind of an excuse me hit. It's a big breaking ball. Darrell tries to check his swing, goes ahead and lays the bat on it, loops it into left field. Took a nice big hop for George Bell. Chet Lemon hustling all the way. Had the throw been on the plate, you can see it would have been awfully close. But the throw is way offline. George Bell did this last night. He threw it about 10 or 15 feet off up the line and home plate, and he does it again tonight. He had a good opportunity to throw Chet out on that play.
Tigers lead 1-0, and Tom Brookins is the batter. He takes a breaking pitch low for a ball. Herndon struck out to open the inning. Lemon doubled, a one-hopper off the left center field wall. Evans follows with a base hit. He is at second, going to second on the throw. 1-0 pitch, grounded foul over beyond the Blue Jays dugout. Brookins with a 251 average, but hitting 309 this month.
Tom has had some big and some key hits for the Tigers. He's tied some games and won some games for him with coming down the stretch.
Here's the pitch outside. 2-1 to Brookins. That's Darrell Evans, who picks up the game's first RBI. He's at second. And the 2-1 pitch from Key is hit off the end of the bat. Foul on the screen. 2-2. It is a cool, crisp, clear evening in Toronto, Ontario. Breeze is blowing out toward right and will be a factor if anything hit that direction.
Typical late October day for Michigan here in Toronto. Very clear and very crisp. brisk wind blowing off the water.
That's popped up on the infield. Who's going to take it? It's going to be Fielder. And there are two out. So Evans stays at second as Brookins pops it up, and Mike Keith will be the batter. Mike Keith, one of the guys that was discussed at length throughout the city today and among the sporting populace. His sensational circus catch made following his collision with Tom Brookins in foul territory last night. He hits in the ninth position. Bats with a run in, two out, and a runner at second base. Key was Toronto's pitcher of the year last season. He was 14 and 11, coming on the heels of a 14 and 6 season 2 years ago.
His ERA was good too. 2 years ago it was 3. Last year 3.57. This year below 3, 2.78. Getting better every year.
In for a strike to Heath, 1-1. He has faced Detroit just once previously this season. He lost 2-1. Breaking pitch, hit to right side, and Barfield is going back and makes the catch. So the Tigers settle for one run on two hits. There are no errors, and one man was left. We'll go to the bottom of the second inning. It's Detroit 1 and Toronto nothing.
Take it from the coach. Kroger is a tiger about saving you money on low cost-cutter specials that'll really make you roar.
Nacho cheese or Cool Ranch Doritos, 16-ounce bag, just $2.29. Three 12-ounce packages of Downy Flake waffles, only $2. And get four 6.5-ounce cans of breast of chicken chunk tuna for $3.
This guy needs a trainer, not a coach. Go Krogering and go Tigers.
Hi, I'm Carl Rose, owner of Carl's Golfland. After 30 years in the golf business, we have been selected by Golf Digest as one of the 100 best golf shops in the USA. Here at Carl's, we offer the finest in selection, quality, and value. This is why long-standing customers won't go anywhere else, and new customers always come back. Now, Titleist golf carts, $59.95 and up. That's Carl's Golfland on Telegraph, just north of Square Lake Road.
Celebrate Beck with Evans' 41st anniversary sale. Celebrate anniversary sale savings store-wide. Celebrate with great values on DuPont Stain Master Carpet. The revolutionary breakthrough with stain resistance never before available. In the latest colors and styles, of course. Celebrate. Save 33% on Cabin Crafts plush of DuPont Stain Master Carpet. Only $13.99, completely installed. Celebrate at Beck with Evans. Since 1946, buying carpet has never been easier.
Of Exhibition Stadium for all. Well, Tiger fans are everywhere in Toronto. Mom and dads are asking for some money. They haven't been here very, it doesn't take very long to spend the allowance here in Toronto, I'm telling you.
No, it doesn't. Even with the exchange, it's still fairly expensive. That was a great sign. They put a lot of time and effort into it.
Tigers lead at 1-0 as we go to the bottom of the second. George Bell will lead it off. Cecil Fielder and Jesse Barfield will follow against Frank Tanana. Bell takes the first pitch, low ball one.
What a great year George Bell's had. Of course, he didn't have a bad one last year. He hit 309 with 31 homers and 108 RBIs. This year, 47 homers, 132 RBIs. In all probability, will probably be the most valuable player. If Toronto should happen to win the division, he certainly probably will be for sure. He probably will be anyway. He's put some awfully good numbers on the board. Of course, Alan Trammell's had a great year too, but this guy's just got too many numbers for Alan, I think.
Yeah, he has been very consistent. He's gotten a lot of notoriety all year, and the home run totals and RBI totals are very impressive, 47 and 132 respectively.
He reminds me of having the year Carl Yastrzemski had in 67 when Carl won the Triple Crown. Seemed like he carried that ball club, especially the last month of the season. George Bell's done the same over here.
Here's the 2-1 pitch to George. Bounces it through for an ace hit. George Bell collects the first Toronto hit of the night, and Cecil Fielder will come up.
Here we see George Bell. It's a good breaking ball. It's in the middle part of the plate. Doesn't try to pull it. And that's what you can't do with Frank Tanana's pulling. Hits the ball right up the middle. If he pulls that ball, he hits it to Trammell at shortstop.
Bell now has 12 hits in those last 25 at-bats. That's just a tad under 500. Cecil Fielder is the batter. And he takes the pitch at the knees for a strike. Cecil has a little bit of an overhang around that belt this trip. Probably got a heavy jersey on, huh?
Could be. I'll tell you, he's too big. You go tell him that he's getting heavy.
No. I think somebody else will, though. Two strikes to count the Fielder. He's batting at a 270 pace with 13 homers and 31 RBIs. Here's the pitch from Tanana. Good save by Heath. Tigers lead it 1-0. We're in the bottom of the second inning. This is the first start for Fielder in about a week. Here's the pitch. Low curve. He got him on strikes. The bat goes sailing all the way past John McLaren, the third base coach, down to the tarp. The Fielder was fooled, and Tanana records his first strikeout of the night.
He got a lot of mileage out of that bat.
The right fielder, number 29.
He's fooled badly. You can see him way out front. About half a day later, here comes the ball. Frank really pulled the string on one, and Fielder let it rip, and the bat went all the way down past third base. Looked like one of my divots went further than the ball.
Jesse Barfield is the batter. He did not play last night. Rick Leach played in right field. Barfield has been platooned a bit this season, and coming off a season in which he had 40 home runs, has not been real excited about it. There's the pitch. That's a little bit low for a ball. 1-0.
I would say he had a legitimate beef. When you hit 289, you have 40 home runs, you have 108 RBIs. The next year, you're hitting 261, which is 20 points lower, but you still have 28 home runs, 82 RBIs, and you don't play every day. It's a little tough to take.
This might be two. Trammell scoops it over to Lou for the first double play. So the Tigers turn away the Blue Jays in the second. No runs, one hit, no errors, and nobody left. We play two in Toronto. It's Detroit 1 and the Blue Jays nothing. The National League scoreboard as we get things going here. It's a 2-1 Chicago victory over the Cardinals, kind of a setback for St. Louis. Houston and Cincinnati scoreless there in the second. Pittsburgh 2-0 over the Mets. They're playing in the first inning. That might help out the Cardinals if that holds up through the balance of the game. Montreal, Philadelphia scoreless in the first. San Francisco and Atlanta scoreless in the second, and San Diego with a late starter out in Los Angeles. In the American League, California has an early 2-1 lead over Cleveland. Sutton and Candiotti pitching there. New York and Baltimore are scoreless there in the first inning. Kansas City and Minnesota scoreless there in the opening inning. Jackson and Straker, the pitchers. And in other games, Boston plays at Milwaukee a little bit later, Chicago at Oakland, and Texas at Seattle.
You're going to take a look. The idea when you take out the second baseman or shortstop on a double play to try to stop it is to get him to skip rope. You got to get there quicker. Get him up in the air and jar him if you can, make him throw the ball away.
Well, the Tigers collect still another hit from Lou Whitaker, each time on the first pitch from Jimmy Key. He has two singles to left field tonight. It's a fourth hit off Key. Two of them belong to this man.
When Lou gets into a rut like this, hitting to center field and left field, he's a 300 hitter, and you can see that ball up in the strike zone again on the outside part of the plate. Probably wasn't even a strike. Lou just lines it politely right into left field, and he can do it with the best of them.
And Bill Madlock will be the batter with a runner at first. Tigers lead it 1-0 at the top of the third. Madlock took a swing and a miss for the third strike in the opening inning. Breaking pitch is high for a ball. Cody. Bill Matlack with his 2,000th career hit at Fenway Park earlier this week. Here's the 1-0 pitch from Key, swung on, foul tiptoe by Charlie Moore, and it's 1-1.
Bill's been up and down with his swing lately the last two or three weeks. He's had his good times, he's had his bad times. He seems to be bodying the ball more rather than using his hands. He needs to look on the end of his bat and reread it. Slow feet, quick hands is what he writes on the knob.
There's a bouncing ball to the left side, grabbed by Moore, the second for one. The throw is off target, and Matlack is safe at first base. Lou Whitaker is forced at second, and Matlack safe on a fielder's choice.
Here we're going to see the play. It's a chopper and gives Matlack a chance to get down there. You can see Whitaker go in, and this is the idea, to get down there, get that infielder in the air, and he can't get as much on the throw, and sometimes you can jar him and throw it away.
One out, runner at first base, and the Tigers lead 1-0. We're in the top of the third inning, and Kirk Gibson, who struck out in his first at-bat, will step up. Gibson has a four-game hitting streak alive, batting .526. He had a couple of hits here last night. First pitch is low for a ball. Jimmy Key, the pitcher of the year here at Toronto last season, delivers the 1-0 pitch low. Former star at Clemson University, where he was most valuable player and all ACC in his final season. A third round pick of Toronto in June of 82. Previously drafted by Cincinnati, but did not sign. Two balls, no strikes, the count to Gibson. Tigers have a runner at first with one out in the top of the third inning. So fouled away, and it's 2-1. Gibson has had some pretty strong games at bat against the Blue Jays this year, including the two hits last night. But he's facing a tough left-hander here this evening. Tossed at first. Matlack didn't have, well, he had very little lead at all. Tigers with a 43-35 win-loss record on the road. 25 games over .500 at home for the Blue Jays. Ground ball left side, grabbed by Orr. The second for one, throw back, safe. Kirk Gibson's fleet feet got him to first base safely in front of the relay, and is safe on a fielder's choice. Blue Jays have had the same play on two occasions, have yet to turn the double play, but they do have two out.
On an average player, it's a double play. Kirk just turns it loose and hustles and gets down to first base and beats the throw. Bill Matlack sliding way short. You see, he can't get there. You slide to get out of the way, because if you don't, they sometimes sidearm and they'll throw that ball and hit you in the coconut right between the eyes. So you've got to get down or you run off baseline, one out of the way.
Gibson at first base, safe on a fielder's choice. Alan Trammell, who sent George Bell to the warning track to close out the first inning, is the batter. Pitch is low for a ball. Grab batting .432 this month. He's bumped his average up to .341. Having a terrific stretch drive.
Last time up, he just missed hitting a high curveball out of here. He hit it good, but the wind's blowing just a little bit from left to right. Held it up a little. Allen didn't get it all.
He rips this one. Whoa, it's called foul by umpire Ken Kaiser. That wasn't foul by a whole lot, but Kaiser was right there and gave a quick signal. I don't know.
Here you see it about 6-8 inches outside the line. Ken Kaiser standing right there. He couldn't have missed that one.
Shouldn't. One ball, one strike to travel. Kirk Gibson is at first base. There are two out. Here's the 1-1 pitch. That's low. Well, former Michigan star Barry Larkin has hit a two-run homer for Cincinnati in the second. A two-run homer to give the Reds a 2-0 lead over Houston. Kirk Gibson, the base runner at first with two out, and a 2-1 count to Alan Trammell. The Tigers trying to add to their 1-0 lead here at Exhibition Stadium. Bouncing ball, foul, past Alex Grammas. We'll be here again tomorrow afternoon. Airtime is 2:15, preceded by the pennant chase at 1:45 on PASS. It'll be Walt Terrell and Dave Steeb. We'll also have Sunday afternoon's game on PASS beginning at 1:30. That'll be Doyle Alexander and Jim Clancy in a matchup of former teammates. 2-2 to Trammell. Inside and low, and it's a full count. That will give Gibson a chance to take off with a pitch.
They're going to play behind Gibby, but still, you want to make sure that Key goes to the home plate. You don't want to make any mistakes and get picked off.
Three and two with two out and a runner at first in the top of the third. And the pitch from Jimmy Key is fouled straight back. Saw the Tigers win loss record on the road at 43-35. That's second best road record in the American League. Toronto has the best, 44-34. One more victory on the road than the Tigers. Three and two to Trammell. There goes Gibson, pitches outside, ball four. Tigers have two on with two out, and Larry Herndon coming up. There are the base runners, Kirk Gibson at second, Alan Trammell at first. Larry Herndon, the strikeout victim of the second, will be the batter.
Larry Herndon's had a big year for the Tigers this year, playing part-time, hitting .327. Started hitting right out of spring training, and he's been fairly consistent the whole year.
Manny Lee made a sensational leaping stab of a liner hit by Larry Herndon with two on in the seventh inning. That would have tied the game last night and possibly set up a go-ahead situation for the Tigers. But Lee moved quickly to his right, leaped high into the air, and picked it off for the final out. Here's the pitch to Herndon. Breaks in low, and it's 2-0. He's up almost 100 points, about 80, over a year ago.
Larry can set to take his pitch right now. He's got two balls, no strikes, two men on. Jimmy Key should come in with a pretty good pitch to hit. Larry is just going to have to decide the area he wants it in and turn it loose.
Jimmy Williams, the manager, out talking with Key.
Key didn't act too interested, did he? He kind of sit off to the side. I think he knew what Jimmy Williams was going to say.
Yeah.
Jimmy wanted to calm him down and give him a chance to take a little bit more time, think about it, get his concentration.
Two balls, no strikes, the count. Tigers have Kirk Gibson at second, Alan Trammell at first with two away, leading the Jays 1-0 in the top of the third. Here's the 2-0 pitch, way outside, 3-0. Key missed a pitching turn in late August in what was said to be a tired arm. He had a full examination. There was no damage found, and he continued on and has built an 8-game winning streak. Here's a 3-0 pitch and a ground ball through to the shortstop. Lee grabs it and he tosses it to Liriano, and that's it. Herndon didn't quite hit it hard enough to get it through the infield, and the Tigers' threat has turned away. No runs, one hit, no errors, and two are left. We'll go to the bottom of the third. It's 1-0 Detroit.
these days of self-service gas stations, computerized banking, and understaffed stores, it seems that no one has the time for personal service anymore. Well, at True Value Hardware Stores, we haven't forgotten that we're working for you. And whenever you have a question or a problem with a do-it-yourself project, we'll do our very best to help. So the next time someone wonders where personal service has gone, you tell them it's still hard at work. Right in here. True Value, more than just a name. It's our way of doing business.
There's a tradition in our state. Every morning, people here spend a few quiet moments with the Morning Free Press. Sure, there may be other ways to start the morning. But not for us.
Guests on Tiger Baseball will receive a gift certificate from Schifrin Jewelers, who feature Longines Wittenauer, the world's most honored watch, backed by service you can trust on all Longines Wittenauer watches at Schifrin Jewelers. And a gift from Moen, the makers of the Pulsation Showerhead, which lets you choose the water flow you like from brisk and pulsating to gently soothing. The Pulsation Showerhead by Moen.
If the question ever comes up, who have been the dominant team since 1983, here's the answer. The Tigers, with just two more victories than Toronto. Those are the top two teams, the Mets and then the Yankees. It's sort of incredible that Toronto and Detroit have almost gone stride for stride since the 83 season.
It is, and yet when you think about it, in the 84 season, the Jays chased the Tigers all the way home, and the Tigers got off to such a great start. Then in 85, the Tigers were in it until, the last 5 weeks. They weren't that far off. And so, and of course, 84, they had a lot of wins. Last year, the Tigers had an up-and-down season, fell out of it early. And this year, of course, looked like they had no chance whatsoever come mid-May, and have played 40-some games over 500 since then.
Frank Tanana has faced the minimum number through the first two innings. He'll take on the lower third of the order now. Garth Orge, Manny Lee, and Charlie Moore. Tigers with a 1-0 lead starting the bottom of the third. Orge playing third base tonight. Vance Mullinix and Kelly Gruber are the men that have seen a lot of action at that position. Slow for a ball, 2-0.
Garth had a big year. He was part of that platoon situation, Mullinix and Ork, in 85 when the Blue Jays won. He hit 313 that year. Hit 260 last year, but this year he's not done well.
There's a long blast. If it stays fair, it's curving. It is foul.
Not only is it foul, had Kirk gotten over in that corner, he might have caught it. The ball really died as the wind blows from left to right field here, and it kills that ball. The ball looked like it was going to go over the roof. We're so far away here, you can see Kirk in the corner, and he got trapped down in there. Had he had enough time to get there, he might have caught it.
When the ball left the bat, it was long gone, but that wind is blowing across from the left field foul pole to the right, and it killed it. So it's 2-1 to Garth Orge. Now he's way out in front of a slow curve, 2-2.
This is Org's first start since August 31st. Not having a good year, only hitting 218. Had two real good years prior to this.
Good look at Frank Tanana as he checks the sign and delivers 2-2. A slow curve is ripped to left. Over after it is Gibson. There's one out. It'll be Manny Lee to bat. It is in this position, offensively, that the Blue Jays feel the loss of Tony Fernandez will hurt them the most. Manny Lee, a very sound defensive player, not quite as spectacular as is Tony Fernandez, but Fernandez carries a much better bat, and that is where, along with the action in the clubhouse, is where they feel it's going to hurt most.
Tony Fernandez was hitting about 322, I believe. Manny Lee probably is a little better defensively at this point in time because Fernandez had a bad knee and wasn't as mobile as he could have been. And this kid here, Lee, is no slouch. He can play shortstop, but he can't hit the same on the same level that Tony Fernandez did. Bad break for Toronto and Tony. But it happens in baseball. It's happened to many others. It'll happen again.
One ball, one strike to count to Manny Lee. He's a switch batter. Hits best from the right. Swing and a miss, 1-2. He carries a 324 average as a right-handed batter. He started the season with Syracuse. Hit 312 there. Brought up to the Jays on the 27th of May. Hit 267 and then went back to Syracuse. Slow curve grounded toward third. Big hop for Brookins. Strong throw low, but he got him. And there are two out in the third inning. Manny Lee heads back to the Blue Jays dugout. It'll bring up Charlie Moore.
The catcher, number 21, Charlie Moore.
Charlie Moore has been moving around a little bit recently. He had a long career and a very fine one with the Milwaukee Brewers, but he's been kind of shuttling around lately. He hits it off the end of the bat, rolling toward first, grabbed and fouled. Charlie gives the Blue Jays an added dimension also in that he not only can catch, he can play in the outfield and first base.
Here we see the ball going right down the line. Darrell Evans tries to get it before it goes foul, but he can't get there in time. It just gets on the foul side of the line.
There are two out now in the bottom of the third inning. Detroit leading at 1-0. Here's the one strike pitch. Low curve is low. 1-1. Moore was signed as a free agent on the 5th of July after starting the season with San Jose in the California League. 1-1 pitch inside with a fastball. 2-1. Here's the 2-1 pitch from Tanana, swung on and missed, and it's 2-2. Tanana shut this team out in Detroit on the 22nd of June, a five-hitter. Tigers won it 2-0. They lead 1-0 in the bottom of the third tonight. Here's the 2-2 pitch. Fastball is inside. It's a full count to Charlie Moore.
Frank trying to get inside on Charlie Moore. You can pitch him in if you have good stuff in there. Then he's always come back either with a curve or the screwball on the outside part of the plate.
Foul straight back, but stays at 3-2. At the Tiger dugout. 3-2 pitch. Right through the middle, knocked out by Tanana. He will not be able to get it. Ball just rolled away. Had it been natural grass, the ball would have rolled dead behind him. He could have picked it up and thrown him out. But it is not. And Charlie Moore has a base hit. Second off Frank Tanana tonight.
The second baseman, number 2.
So Nelson Liriano will be the batter.
Here we see the pitch. It's a low fastball. Charlie Moore is a good fastball hitter. Tanana almost makes a good play. Takes a pop at it. His glove looked like it was closed when it hit it, and then it rolls on the rug, and no play.
Charlie Moore is at first base with two out, and Nelson Liriano is the batter. Liriano grounded out to Darrell Evans in the opening inning. Tigers lead it 1-0. Foster first. A pitch from Tanana. Cut the outside corner for a strike. Done a pretty good job with the bat since arriving here in Toronto. Hitting safely in 22 of 28. A little bit low for a ball. Liriano didn't win many fans among the Tigers today. He categorized the slide of Bill Madlock last night as a dirty play. Pitch is low for a ball, 2-1. And the Tigers did not take that lightly.
Especially Sparky.
Sparky ripped him a little.
Yes, he did. Sparky ripped a lot of people today. I was a little bit surprised, but Sparky was adamant about it. You play the game tough, that's the way it's supposed to be played.
2-1 pitch is a strike on the outside corner.
It wasn't a dirty slide. Bill Madlock didn't go down and maliciously try to get anyone hurt. He tried to break up the double play as any good base runner would, and unfortunately, the Fernandez fell on his elbow.
2 balls, 2 strikes, 2 out, and a runner at first in the bottom of the third inning. Here's the 2-2 pitch. Curve is low. And it's a full count for Liriano. Frank has struck out a batter. He has not walked anyone. He has given up 2 hits. One to Bell up the middle. And the infield single to Charlie Moore here with 2 out in the third. 3-2 pitch. Ground ball and speared by Tanana. And that's it for the Jays in the third. No runs, 1 hit, no errors, 1 left. We're a third of the way through. It's Detroit 1 and the Blue Jays nothing.
True Value Hardware Store's best interior paint just got even better. That's because now all 3 True Test Easy Care finishes, flat semi-gloss and flat enamel, are spatter resistant. So now you can give your rooms a rich, lasting coat without making a big mess. And after all, you're supposed to be painting your walls, not yourself. You'll find spatter resistant True Test Easy Care paint exclusively at most True Value Hardware stores and home centers.
I wish Mommy was here.
Who do you think made Mommy feel better when she was your age?
You, Grandpa?
Over 20 million times every year, people bring their prescriptions to a Kmart pharmacy.
2 teaspoons?
For top brand name pharmaceuticals or generic equivalents where allowed.
Feels better.
And precise computerized prescription service, all at a Kmart price.
I thought this might make you feel better, too.
America's favorite store, Kmart, the saving place.
It's a Major League clearance sale going on now. Get 1.9% financing on Tempo and Escort, or get 1.9 financing on Taurus and Thunderbird. Get 1.9 financing on Ranger or Bronco too. Hurry, everything is clearance priced for Major League savings.
See one of these quality dealers today.
Pat Milliken, Redford. Tom Holzer, Farmington Hills. Dick McQuiston, Flat Rock. Dean Sellers, Troy.
Don't miss that Major League clearance sale at your Metro Detroit Ford dealers.
It's time for tonight's Detroit Tiger movie giveaway. If you'd like to own your own copy of the Detroit Tigers, the movie, you can call 1-800-262-2277 to order your own copy at the special low price of $19.95. Operators are on duty to take your orders. Tonight's first lucky winner drawn earlier today is Brenda Smith of Baldwin, Michigan. Our congratulations for winning our past Tiger movie giveaway contest. 1-0 in a brilliant pitching duel at Exhibition Stadium as we go to the fourth. Larry Herndon will lead it off, or Chet Lemon rather, and he hits a broken bat pop fly caught by Manny Lee. So there's one out in the fourth inning.
The first baseman, number 41, Darrell Evans.
Darrell Evans will be the batter. He singled home the Tigers' only run in the second inning. He lofted one to left.
It was an excuse me type hit, and I'm sure Darrell will take it. Makes up for some of those line drives that are caught.
Here's the pitch from Jimmy Key. It's a little bit low. Key has allowed a run on 4 hits, struck out 3, and walked 1. There's a broken bat. Ball picked off by Fielder. 2 are out of the fourth inning. And Tom Brookins will be the batter.
The third baseman, number 16, Tom Brookins.
Two up, two down in the fourth inning. Here's the pitch from Jimmy Key. A curve is in for a strike at the knees. That's a strike on the outside corner. 0-2 as he came right back with a fastball. And the 0-2 pitch. Fouled out of Moore's mitt. Brookins is alive.
Jim Key reminds you of a look a little bit the way he pitches, a young Mike Flanagan. Flanagan had maybe a little bit more velocity than Key. Probably not. They're pretty much equal. Big breaking ball. Very good motion. Hard to tell which pitch he's throwing.
The 0-2 delivery is high. A ball and two strikes.
Hitters will categorize a pitcher like Key as sneaky quick. Ball gets up there a little bit quicker than you think. Good motion is why.
Here's the 1-2 delivery way outside. 2-2. Pitch fouled away. Flanagan gives you a little more of that peekaboo look too than does.
Yeah, he has a little bigger motion, turns a little bit more, and he changes speeds on his curveball just a little more than Jim Key. But they release the ball similar, their curve and their fastball. They both good arm motion on both pitches.
2-2 again. Bounce foul over by the Toronto dugout. Yes, either one you could put on your pitching staff and not be too concerned about sending him out there.
Mike Flanagan had some great years before he lost the real good velocity. He's won three over here in Toronto since coming from the Orioles.
Another foul, and it stays 2-2. Mets are leading the Pirates 3-2. They're in the second at Shea Stadium. The Cubs beat the Cardinals earlier today 2-1. Montreal trails Philadelphia 1-0 in the third. Cincinnati 2-0 over Houston in the third. And Atlanta leads the Giants 1-0. They're in the fourth inning. So the National League scores we have for you. And the 2-2 pitch is hit to right field. Jesse Barfield is over toward the line. Makes the catch, and the Tigers for the first time this evening are out in order. No runs, no hits, no errors, and nobody left. We'll go to the bottom of the fourth inning. It's Detroit 1 and Toronto 0.
Together, building day by day, for all things you need along the way, we'll understand and lend a helping hand. Ask us, we're Herb Lumber.
Storage problems? Herb Lumber offers custom-built handy barns in 8 roomy sizes that will handle all your storage needs. Our handy barn packages include all building materials, even the hardware and nails. Of course, Herb Lumber, we're buildings.
Ask us, we're Herb Lumber.
If you're moving, get Ryder's free move-it-yourself guide. From picking the best truck to packing your lamps, it'll help you handle almost everything.
Got a spot for this?
What's that?
Here.
If you're planning to move cross-country, cross-town, or just around the corner, call Ryder. And get moving with an easy Ryder value. Ryder. We're there at every turn.
They've been very dependable, tremendous value, fun to drive.
More Hondas are on their way, still number one in customer satisfaction. Listen, these Honda owners were asked to compare their Hondas to other cars.
For the price that you pay for a Honda, there is no comparison.
The Honda's a lot better.
There's just no comparison.
No comparison.
Would you buy another Honda?
You bet. I wouldn't drive anything but a Honda.
Hurry. It's the last of the 87s at your four county Honda dealers.
At the end of tonight's game, we'll be choosing the key moment of the game, which will be brought to you by Cousins Clothes and Cousins Big and Tall, both on Southfield Road and Lathrop Village. That key moment will be what we think is the turning point of tonight's game. It is on the cool side in Toronto, Ontario. Everybody has come bundled up, but nevertheless, there are a few goosebumps around. Lloyd Mosby will start off the fourth inning for Toronto. The Jays down 1-0. Mosby, Benitez, and George Bell to face Frank Tanana, who has shut them out on two hits. Here's the 1-0 delivery. That's slowing away. Blue Jays have made a move. They have purchased the contract of Alexis Infante from Syracuse, the International League. He's a 24-year-old right-handed hitting shortstop. Hit 226 at Syracuse with two homers and 30 RBIs. He's expected to be here in time for tomorrow's game. Here's the 2-0 pitch. That's in for a strike, 2-1. He will back up Manny Lee, who is the shortstop for the duration of Fernandez sideline.
The only player they have now who can play shortstop if he has to is Kelly Gruber.
Yep.
Not really a shortstop. That's why they're going to bring young man up so he can back up Lee if anything happens to Lee.
Here's the 2-1 pitch. Ground ball left side. Oh, it came off of Alan Trammell. Goes into shallow right. Lou Whitaker hustles it down and keeps him at first. That looked like trouble from the opening gun. And it came up off Alan Trammell's wrist, I believe, and scooted to shallow right center. Whitaker hustled out to get it and kept Mosby at first base.
Excellent play by Lou Whitaker to back up this play. Otherwise, Lloyd would have been on second base. You can see the ball's hit hard up the middle, right at Allen, and it took a big hop. You know what it did? It hit that flat spot where the infield is skin. Took a higher hop than Allen anticipated and caught him in the wrist. Good play by Lou Whitaker to back that play up.
Blue Jays have the leadoff man aboard, and Juan Benitez with that. One strike to Benitez. Benitez with a long look at John McLaren, who was sending the signs from the third base coaching box. Fastball puts him off, 1-1. Mosby is the third base runner of the night. That's McLaren for the Toronto Blue Jays. George Bell had a leadoff single in the second, was cut down in a double play. Charlie Moore had an infield single with two out in the third. That's high for a ball. That's 1-2-1. Detroit leads 1-0, scoring the game's only run in the second inning on back-to-back hits, a double and then a single by Darrell Evans. The 2-1 pitch is popped foul and out of play. We'd like to take a moment to pass along our sympathies and best wishes to the family of Duffy Doherty. Duffy passed away this morning in Santa Monica, California. Duffy, you'll recall, was the head football coach at Michigan State for 19 seasons. He was 72 years old, has been ill for the last several weeks. Terrific guy, and he will be missed. That's fouled away. Fine coach, just a great sense of humor. Everybody loved Duffy. Juan Benitez checking in again with John McLaren
as Mosby goes back to first base. The count is 2-2. Tanana will keep Mosby close as he's a threat to steal. He has 31 steals this year. Another foul out of play. McLaren managed Mosby when they were both at Medicine Hat, which is the A team for Toronto. If anybody knows Mosby, it's McLaren. Again, the pitch from Tanana, it's at high in the left. Kirk Gibson is back. He has it. There's one out, and Mosby trots back to first base. One gone in the fourth, and now it is George Bell. The way to pitch, Juan Benicas is inside. He likes to get his arms out. He likes the ball out over the plate, or he can hit it to center and right center. Frank Tanana kept trying to come in and get Benicas. He was inside. The last pitch, he finally got in and jammed him a little bit. Hit a fly ball to left field. George Bell had the first hit of the night for Toronto. That was a leadoff single of the second inning. He was erased in the front half of a double play. He's up there now with a runner at first and one out in the fourth inning. Well, Mike Schmidt has just homered for Philadelphia, a two-run homer, scoring Von Hayes in front of him to give the Phils a 3-0 lead over Montreal. That was number 528 in his career.
It's about 32 or 3 for the season. He's talking about quitting. I don't think he will. 100 RBIs, having a great year.
It's number 33 this year for Schmidt. Guy at the plate has 47 for Toronto, George Bell. 132 RBIs, and he takes a curve at the knees, a beauty. One ball, one strike.
Good curveball. Bottom dropped out of it.
Another slow curve, missed outside, 2-1. Bell showing a little patience with that curve. Wasn't too long ago, too many years ago, he was up there breaking his back on that type of pitch. Two-one delivery, fastball backs him off. Now it's 3-1. Frank has not walked a batter tonight. He has one strikeout. He's given up three hits. Runner at first is Lloyd Mosby. One out. The count is 3-1. There goes Mosby. Pitch is popped up. Whitaker is back in the outfield. He has it, and there are two away. Big out for the Tigers left-hander in the fourth inning, getting George Bell. And now with two away, Cecil Fielder will be the batter. Fielder fanned in the second inning. One strike to count the Fielder. We'll be here again tomorrow afternoon. Airtime 2:15. Walt Terrell and Dave Steve. Pennant chase. Kicks things off at 1:45 tomorrow afternoon. And then Sunday's finale on Pass will feature Doyle Alexander and Jim Clancy. Airtime is 1:30. Here's the one strike pitch, and it's hit at Lou over his glove. Mosby hits the corner, heads for third. Here's the throw. It's cut off by Trammell. They have them at the corners with two outs. Fielder's line drive over the outstretched glove of a leaping Lou Whitaker. And the Jays have them at first and third. Ball's inside on fielder, up and in, and he kind of gets half jammed. Hits a looping line drive right over Lou Whitaker's head. Lou made a vain attempt. He didn't come very close to it. Not much he could do about it. Man on first and third. Two outs. And Jesse Barfield is the batter. That's Mosby at third base. Fielder at first. Barfield hit into a double play to end the second inning. The pitch from Tanana is in for a strike. Quite a contrast in batting average against southpaws and righties for Barfield this year. Here's the one strike pitch. Good save by Heath. No advance on the part of the runners. Talking with Whitey Lockman, and the new baseball people will remember, played for 15 years in the big leagues. Very impressed with Mike Heath's performance last night. He said if there's any one that was a valuable player last night, it was him. As Jack Morris, forkball, kept dipping into the dirt in front, and Heath was able to keep all but one in front of him. And kept the game close.
It's big for a pitcher to be able to know he can throw a ball in the dirt and it's going to be stopped. Gives him a lot of confidence in it. He's not afraid to turn the ball loose. Mike Heath did a great job last night. He's already blocked two or three curveballs in the dirt, and Tanana has to feel comfortable that his catcher can handle that pitch so he can go ahead and break that curveball off and not worry about it if it bounces up there.
Two balls and a strike to count to Barfield. Runners at first and third. Curve is a little low. Now it's 3-1.
You never want to have to pitch with the bases loaded if you can help it, but I'd be surprised if Tanana gives in to Barfield with Garth Orr coming up next. Garth hitting 218. Barfield is a dangerous hitter. 28 home runs.
3-1 pitch, and he didn't come close. He'd much rather pitch to Ort with the bases loaded. And that is what's going to happen as Sparky comes out. There's nothing going on in the Tiger bullpen.
That was an unintentional, intentional walk. He just didn't want to pitch to Jesse, and I don't blame him. Garth Ort is coming up next, not having a good year. Sparky just wants to come out and make sure that's what he had in mind. Give him a little breather and not get to pitching too fast.
Take the walk.
Must be cold. Sparky's got batting gloves on both hands. I know he's not going up there to hit.
No, let's hope not. Orge is one of the three remaining Blue Jays from the expansion draft. Jim Sancy and Ernie Witt are the other two. Back closing down what has been a lengthy career with the Jays. He's up there with the bases loaded and two out. He lined to Kirk Gibson to open the third inning. Tigers lead it 1-0. We're in the bottom of the fourth inning. And the pitch to Orr. Ground ball left side. Cram grabs it. Toss to Lou, and that's it for the Jays. So the Tigers turn away the Blue Jay threat. Toronto gone with no runs, two hits. There are no errors, and three were left. We'll go to the fifth inning. It's Detroit 1 and Toronto nothing.
Some of life's odds are better than others. For example, the odds of talking your way out of this ticket are not especially good. The odds of you saying something incredibly witty right now are somewhat discouraging. But if you play Greenbacks, the new instant lottery game, the odds are better than 1 in 4 that you could be one of millions to win up to $1,000 instantly. Compare that to the odds of the boss not caring you're late.
We don't need to tell you that winter is coming. Church's Lumber Yards can help plug up those gaps and cracks old man winter always finds. Church's has a variety of easy-to-use insulation kits and weather stripping. Also, extra Owens Corning insulation blankets and energy shields can warm things up. And see Church's excellent selection of do-it-yourself storm doors. Also, you'll need caulking around those windows and doors. There's a Church's Lumber Yard near you.
Trust us to help you.
When you buy a used car through the classifieds, you need cash.
It's only Daddy.
And sometimes a couple of creative ways to get it. But why scrape for every penny?
10 more cans.
But at Don Foss Used Cars, all you need is $99 down. Because Don Foss has something private sellers don't. Easy financing. So before you tap all your resources.
Back again already?
Come to where the prices won't bleed you dry. And $99 down can get you a good used car. Don Foss.
Here we're going to see Garth Orange jumps on the first pitch. Pretty good curveball breaking down in the strike zone in the middle. Hits it hard, but Alan Trammell's there and makes sure of this one and catches it. It's easy force play at second base. Gets the Tigers out of a jam. That was good pitching, I thought, by Frank Tanana. He chose to go around Jesse Barfield, who is a potential home run hitter and a tough hitter. Pitch to the guy that really isn't having a good season. You never know how it's going to turn out, but it worked well in that situation.
Mike Keith leads off the Detroit fifth. He hammers it at Orch, who picks it off and throws him out. That's five straight batters retired by Jimmy Key now. The Blue Jays starting the fifth inning with somebody in the bullpen. He's a right-hander. We can't see from here just who it is. Lou Whitaker will bat. He and the two previous at-bats hit the first pitch thrown by Key and drilled them to left for base hits. Tigers lead it 1-0 at the top of the fifth inning, trying to draw even in this four-game series. It's inside for a ball. Tigers trail by a game and a half in the Eastern Division standings. Here's the 1-0 pitch. That's low. Guess not. Jim McKean went up with the right hand. It's one ball, one strike.
Gave us a slow call right then. It looked like a pretty good pitch. It's awfully hard to tell on the monitor sometimes, but McKean thought it was a strike.
There's the 1-1 delivery. Ground ball left side. Manny Lee scoops it and throws him out. Two up, two down in the fifth inning. And it'll be Bill Madlock to bat. Tigers have Jimmy Key in a jam. This is Johnson throwing the bullpen. The usual ovation given Bill Madlock as he steps up following last night's collision. He's 0 for 2 tonight. He has struck out and hit into a force play. One ball, no strikes, the count to Madlock. Have a run on four hits. The Jays no runs on three. Two balls and a strike.
Fans love it. Fans love it. Not to the team up and in. It won't bother Bill Madlock for one second.
It's hit hard past Alex Stramas. Baltimore leading the Yankees 2-1 after an inning in Baltimore. That's a bit of an upset the way the Orioles have been going. Minnesota 2, Kansas City nothing. They're in the second at the Metrodome as the Twins continue to wind down the West. There's a broken bat pop-up. Manny Lee will pick it off. And the Tigers are gone in order for the second straight inning. No runs, no hits, no errors, and nobody left. We're halfway through tonight's game. It's Detroit 1 and the Blue Jays nothing.
The name is Violetel.
Violetel what?
Violetel is the name.
Okay, now listen, everybody. Who's celebrating the grand opening of Metro Detroit's newest Isuzu showroom?
Violetel.
No, it's Violetel. Grand opening savings on every Isuzu car and truck. New showroom, lots of Isuzus at...
Wear your tire.
See Violetel on Van Dyke Avenue.
Violetel.
Hey, Sparky, what do you think of Metro 25's two-way guarantee?
It is the absolute easiest way to buy tires, no doubt about it. Metro 25 guarantees high mileage and the lowest prices. I mean, it's just fantastic. And only Metro 25 has a two-way guarantee. It's unbelievable.
Uniroyal Tiger Paw Plus Steel Belt at off-season radials as low as $28.50, guaranteed 3 years or 50,000 miles.
It's one of a kind. Does that answer your question?
What was the question?
It's time for another Detroit Tiger movie giveaway. If you'd like to own your own copy of the Detroit Tigers, the movie, you can call 1-800-262-2277 to order your own copy at the special low price of $19.95. Operators are on duty to take your order. Tonight's second lucky winner, drawn earlier today, is Kathy Kuypers of Midland, Michigan. Our congratulations for winning our past Tiger movie giveaway contest. Frank Tanana did a brilliant job in pitching out of a very tight situation in the fourth inning to preserve a 1-0 lead. He now faces Manny Lee, who pops up the first pitch. Lou Whitaker going out to the outfield, but it's Herndon who comes roaring in and makes the catch. Charlie Moore will be the batter. Frank Tanana doing or presenting a clinic-type situation in how to pitch around a hitter in the fourth inning. Pitched around Jesse Barfield to load the bases with two out, and then got Garth Orch to ground into a force play. Frank has struck out one, walked one, has allowed four hits. He has a 1-0 lead. Charlie Moore had an infield single in his first at-bat. He banged it right back to the box. Tanana knocked it down but couldn't hold it, and then it rolled away from him. In for a strike. 0-1. The stadium is full. Our television booth is full. They all came up to see you, I think, Fox. Get your autograph.
Could be. I seriously doubt that. I don't think there are any seats. I don't see many.
No, I'm talking about those in the booth here.
Yeah, I know. Well, they're all up here. No booze yet, mostly cheers, so I guess we're doing okay.
That's the B-O-O-S, I think you're...
Oh, no, yeah, booze, did I kind of say it like with some Z's?
Slurred
it
a little, yeah.
Slurred it? That even makes it worse, doesn't it?
Yeah. 1-1 pitch is low for a ball, and it's two balls and a strike to Charlie Moore. The largest crowd they've had here was on July 1st when the Yankees were in town. They had over 47,000. We have 42 plus last night, and it's considerably larger than last evening. There's a fly ball to left field. Kirk Gibson coming in. He is under it, and there are two out of the fifth inning.
I don't know if the crowds can get any bigger for Saturday and Sunday, but there isn't a ticket to be had, and the scalpers are having a heyday out in the lots. There just aren't any tickets for anywhere in this stadium for Saturday and Sunday.
They're gone. All the rooms in town are gone. Hotels are full. Restaurants are full. Hotel lobbies are full. Stadium's full. That's the way it should be.
Big doings.
Big time in the big city. Nelson Lariano is the batter with two out and nobody on. Tigers lead it 1-0. One strike to count to Liriano. He has grounded to first and tapped it back to the mound. Curve is in for a strike, and it's 0-2. A lot of baseball coming up here on Pass. All of the Tiger games from this point on to the season's end will be carried here on Pass. Curveball, bounce to the left side, charged by Brookins, pick up, throw, got him. Nice play by Tom Brookins, who had to hustle because Liriano can virtually fly. The side is out in order in the fifth. No runs, no hits, no errors, and nobody left. We'll go to the sixth. It's still 1-0 Detroit. Something started against Jimmy Key, who has been tougher than the proverbial nails for the last two innings. He has retired every man he has faced him in order. The pitch to Gibby, bunts it down the right side. Key on quickly, throws wild. Gibson will hit for second, and he'll have to stop there, but it's a big break for the Tigers. They put the leadoff man at second base. Key hurried his throw and threw poorly to Cecil Fielder, and Gibson motored on to second.
Key had plenty of time, and it was a routine play, but as you said, he hurried that throw badly. We'll see. Kirk doesn't bunt it hard enough to get it past the pitcher. Key comes off. He's got all the time in the world. Throws sidearm and tries to spot it. Throws it into the runner and up the line, not even close. Real poor play by Jimmy Key. Got him in trouble.
Well, Gibson is at second base as a result of the error, and Alan Trammell has a chance to pad the Tiger lead. Trammell hit it deep to left field in the first at-bat, walked in his second trip. Bunts it down the third baseline. That'll get Gibson over, and the throw, save! Alan Trammell hustling down the line, beat it for a base hit. Gibson goes to third, and the Tigers have two on with nobody out in the sixth inning. Another source of offense that has not been utilized a great deal by Detroit.
You won't see many fourth hitters do this. Alan Trammell just makes a perfect bunt down the third baseline. Garth Org was playing him deep, didn't expect him to hit. Alan has the ability to go the other way. It's a bang-bang play, but he's safe. Here, Org has to come up and make a hurried throw, and he does make a good one. Trammell beats the throw, man on first and third.
It's the fifth Tiger hit of the night. Gibson is at third base. Tram is at first. And Larry Herndon is up there as they start to get some action in the Toronto bullpen. Key had retired seven straight batters before Gibson's bunt to open the sixth. Pitch is low and inside for ball one to Herndon. Larry has struck out and hit into a force play.
Sparky let Larry hit 3-0 with the bases loaded. Hit a ground ball. Eichhorn warming up in the Toronto bullpen.
Eichhorn has been sort of the forgotten soul in the Toronto bullpen recently, with Ward and Wells coming on the scene. And he was quoted earlier as saying that he does not expect to be back with the Blue Jays next year.
Here's a situation here, 2-0. You look for your pitch in the middle to the outside part of the plate and drive it deep to the outfield.
He rips it to left. Gibson will score. Trammell will have to stop at second. Tigers lead 2-0. Larry Herndon with a solid single in the left field, and the Tigers add to their lead with Gibby scoring from third. 46 RBIs for Larry Herndon. And Jimmy Williams is going out to talk with Jimmy Key. Isn't it something, though, the bunt, that all the power that the Tigers possess may ultimately lead to Key being forced from the mound?
Well, he buried himself when he threw the made the two base throwing error. That got him in the biggest trouble. And then Allen dropped down a perfect bunt, put runners at first and third. Larry Herndon on a 2-0 pitch. Larry gets a breaking ball, 2-0, right in the middle part of the plate, and he hits a line drive right between the infielders to score Kirk Gibson. Key is still in trouble with a man on first and second. Nobody out.
Herndon's 46th RBI of the year. Tigers lead it 2-0. Chet Lemon doubled in the second inning, scored the Detroit's first run, and he popped out to the shortstop in the fourth. Don Mattingly has hit a grand slam home run for the Yankees, and Dave Winfield has followed with the bases empty homer. It's 7-2, New York leading Baltimore. Here's the pitch from Key. It's popped up. Infield fly rule in effect as Fielder makes the catch. One out in the sixth inning. The grand slam by Mattingly is his fifth of the season, which ties the major league record held by Ernie Banks and Jim Gentile. Here's a man that has clubbed a few in his career. He has a total of 31 home runs this year. He has a run scoring single to his credit tonight. He lined sharply to Fielder, who picked it off in the fourth. He's one for two. Darrell Evans, the batter. Runners at first and second, a run in and one out. And the pitch is low and away. Here's the 1-0 pitch, and it's popped foul out of play. Jeff Musselman has joined the bullpen corps. Eichhorn continues to throw. You see the former Tiger, John Sullivan, bullpen coach down there. 1-1, the count to Darrell Evans. The Tigers trying to add to their 2-0 lead here in the top of the sixth. There's a bouncing ball foul. Stays at the ball and two strikes. Evans failed to hit safely last night. He had a loop single in the left in his first at bat this evening. Jimmy Key trying to pitch out of a tight spot. Two on, one out. The 1-2 pitch came from the side and almost got him. 2-2. Evans with 31 home runs. The Tigers have 211. It's two more than the Blue Jays. A long blast here would look mighty big for the Tigers. Here's a 2-2 pitch, low and away, full count. The base runners, Alan Trammell at second, Larry Herndon at first. One out and the 3-2 pitch due Evans. Line to left field, curving away from Bell, but he's over to get it, and there are two out. It'll be up to Tom Brookins in the Tigers' sixth inning. Brookins is 0 for 2. Gibson opened the inning with the bunt that Key threw down into the Blue Jay bullpen, or the Tiger bullpen. He went to second on the error. Then a bunt single by Alan Trammell. The Tigers had runners at first and third. And the Herndon singled home Kirk Gibson. Lemon then fouled out. Evans lines out. Runners at first and second. Two away and a one strike pitch to Tom Brookins. Now it's two strikes. Here's the 0-2 pitch. This is outside. Charlie Moore was ready to go. The rest of the Blue Jays are ready to hit for the dugout. Jim McKeon, hopefully we've got a little more time here yet.
Here we can see the pitch. He tries to hit that outside corner with a little cut slider. It was a strike when he caught it, but it went around the plate. Good call by the umpire from here anyway.
1-2 to Tom Brookins. Big run out there at second base. 1-2 pitch and a curve. It's popped up. Down the infield, it's going to be Fielder to take it. And the Tigers are out. They settle for a run on two hits. There was an error. And two are left. We'll go to the bottom of the sixth. It's Detroit 2 and Toronto nothing. The Detroit Detroit Tigers lead the Toronto Blue Jays 2-0 in the bottom of the sixth inning of game two of this four-game series, which continues tomorrow afternoon. We'll have it for you at 2:15 and concludes at 1:30 Sunday afternoon. We'll have it also here on Pass. We invite you to join us for all of the Tiger games through the balance of the season. Lloyd Mosby will start it off for the Toronto Blue Jays in the sixth inning. He had a single in the fourth inning, started what looked to be a fruitful uprising for the Jays, but Tanana slammed the door. Pitch is low and away. Tanana got the final out with the bases loaded and preserved the shutout. It's in for a strike. 1-1. Pitch is low for a ball. They apparently have changed the scoring on Mosby's first at bat to an error rather than a single, so it's a three hitter that Tanana has going now. This time it's an easy bouncer to Lou Whitaker, and Mosby's out number one. Juan Beniquez is the batter. Beniquez, a couple of fly balls to left field tonight. Two, six, and one for Detroit, 0-3-1 for the Jays. That's the way the scoreboard totals read now. Breaking pitch is low for a ball. Pops out of Heath's glove. Ball, no strikes to Juan Beniquez, hitting in the third slot. That is the position that Tony Fernandez had been hitting. Here's the 1-0 pitch. Big curve is in for a strike and a dandy. 1-1. It's lined towards center. Chet Lemon came in, goes back and picks it off. Two away. And George Bell will be the batter. Bell is 1-for-2 tonight. Last night he had three consecutive hits before they finally got him on a pop foul.
And ideally, when you're facing a guy having a most valuable player type year, you want to face him with nobody on. Nobody on the bases, he can't hurt you too bad.
Curve is a little low for a ball. Mel Hall has just homered for the Cleveland Indians, tying the game with California 5-5. One ball, no strikes. Ground ball, one hopper to Brookins. He's got a long throw, but he gets his man, and the side is out in order for the second straight inning. No runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left. We're two-thirds of the way through. The Tigers lead it 2-0. We're moving to the top of the seventh inning. The number nine man of the Tiger order, Mike Heath, will lead it off. He takes strike one from Jimmy Key. It'll be Heath, Whitaker, and Bill Madlock facing the Toronto left-hander. Heath is 0-for-2 tonight. Checks the swing, but it's in, strike two. A bunt by Kirk Gibson that was thrown down to the Tiger bullpen by Jimmy Key, followed by a bunt single by Alan Trammell, and a run-scoring base hit by Larry Herndon, adding on a Tiger run in the sixth inning after they had posted one in the second on a double by Lemon and a base hit by Darrell Evans. Here's the two-strike pitch to Heath. That's low. Victory throwing in the Detroit bullpen. Here's the 1-2 pitch, fouled away. Frank Tanana in the first six innings has probably done more than the Tigers could have hoped for, coming off some shaky starts, shutting out the Jays on three hits.
He's pitched very, very well. He's had pretty good control, stayed ahead of the hitters, and kept the ball out of the middle of the plate for the most part. And when he has, they've hit line drives at the fielders, and that helps a lot.
Two balls, two strikes to Mike Heath. Look out. Ball goes one way, the bat the other. Back in it by Orange. The throw is low. He's safe. Jimmy Key got out of the way of the flying bat, and Mike Heath beat the throw from Garth Orange.
Mike Heath has pretty good speed for a catcher. He's fooled on this pitch. The bat goes at Key. Key's got a duck. He's not going to field it. Garth Orange is playing very deep, comes in, backhands the ball, makes a good throw. Mike Heath just beats it.
Mike Heath, the base runner. He has the seventh hit off Jimmy Key tonight. Lou Whitaker is the batter. Garth Orange is in third. Fielder holding with Heath at first. Whitaker single in the first, single in the third, grounded out in the fifth inning. In both the first and third, he singled on the first pitch thrown him by Key. He squares, misses. I got a piece of it, I guess. Fouls it at the plate, one strike. One strike to count to Whitaker. Toss to Firth. Heath is back. Here's the one strike pitch. He hits it to left field fairly deep. George Bell is back, however, and makes the catch. The Tigers change sides. Whitaker going to the left side for the fourth straight time. This time flies out, and there's one gone with Bill Madlock, the batter. Madlock is 0 for 3 tonight. He struck out, hit into a forced play, and popped out. Well, he has become legendary in one game at Exhibition Stadium.
They're keeping the fans awake anyway. They're giving them something to cheer about, as Toronto hasn't done too much at the plate, but they're having a good time getting on Bill Madlock.
Dave Nightingale, the fine sports writer for the Sporting News, had an interesting comment today at the hotel. He said, "I didn't realize that I was going to be a witness to a mortal sin in my lifetime." And I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "Bill Madlock breaking up a double play. It's a mortal sin up here." And that's about the way it's been treated. He's gotten a lot of notoriety, and none of it good around here. Runner at first base, one out. One strike to count to Madlock. Bouncing ball, rolling foul. It's two strikes to Madlock. It has been a nifty pitching duel between this man, Jimmy Key, and Frank Tanana.
Indeed it has. Jimmy Key threw a ball away that ended up in a run scoring, and the first run was scored on a bloop hit. So he's really pitched very well. Down 2-0, Frank Tanana just pitched that much better.
Madlock swings and fouls it at the plate. He pitched 9 innings against the Tigers in his previous outing against Detroit this year. A complete game, gave up 4 hits, struck out 6, but still lost 2-1.
Jim Key has lost three or four games, 2-1, 1-0, 3-2. He could have been easily a 20-game winner by now. He's had a little bit of hard luck, even though he's pitched extremely well.
There's the two-strike pitch outside, 1-2. The 1-2 delivery, Madlock bounces it to the left side. Big hop, fielded there. Second, first, safe on the relay. Mike Keith went on very hard at second base. A quick throw was not quick enough to nail Bill Madlock, who was safe on a fielder's choice.
Here we see the ball. Short to second, Heath gets down there and it makes a big difference. They don't get quite as much on the throw as they would, and Bill Madlock, the old timer, showing a little speed. That's twice he's beat out a ground ball situation.
He may have to sleep in tomorrow and rest up from all of this energy he's exerting here.
The old war horse got down the line good, kept the inning alive.
Two are out now with a runner at first, and Kirk Gibson is the batter, and he pops it up. Manny Lee is called for it. Tigers are out in the seventh inning. No runs, one hit, no errors, one left. We go to the bottom of the seventh inning. It's still Detroit 2 and Toronto nothing.
For the best 87 closeout prices on Porsche, Audi. Up to $2,000 cash back on select Mazda. Special lease rates on Porsche. Special savings on Audi 5000. Unbeatable $4,500 cash rebate on Audi 4000. 4000 GT coupes and Quattro 4000. This closeout's a knockout. Grand River at 10 Mile in Farmington Hills. Porsche, Audi.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's Highland's anniversary, and to celebrate, we thought we'd give all employees the week off. Yay! But on second thought, we decided to do something great for our customers, so we're going to give them a sale.
Save on this GE VHS video recorder with HQ and wireless remote, just $227.
Of course, with savings like these, the stores will be mobbed, so we'll have to work extra hard. Sound great, Hackett?
Yippee.
The Highland Superstore's anniversary sale.
Scotch XS2 audio cassettes. For people who take music to excess. Scotch XS2 audio cassettes from 3M, worldwide sponsor, 1988 Olympic Games.
At all 23 Harmony House locations.
the end of tonight's game, we'll be choosing someone to be named the Soft Cloth Boys Tiger Player of the Game. The Detroit Tigers and the Soft Cloth Boys Car Washes, both number one in Metro Detroit.
Pete Page, Tom Bickerseth, and Bill Supernaw are here tonight from the townhouse in Charlevoix. I want to say hello to all the people that watch us on pass back in Charlevoix.
Bottom of the seventh inning, Cecil Fielder, Jesse Barfield, and Garth Orge to face Frank Tanana. Tigers lead it 2-0. Fielder is 1-for-2 tonight. A struck out and singled. Takes the first pitch outside, ball one. Doing a little additional checking on Jimmy Key. We're talking about his tight losses. The last three games that he has lost have been by one run. That's foul straight back. He lost 2-1 to the Tigers on a four hitter, a complete game performance. To Milwaukee, 3-2, complete game three hitter. And 2-1 to Kansas City, a complete game three hitter. Tonight he has allowed seven hits to the Tigers and trails 2-0. Swing and a miss. 1-2. Frank changing the signs a little bit. Now Fielder steps out. The count is 1-2 to the leadoff man in the Toronto half of the seventh inning. Here's the 1-2 pitch, reaches out, hits it high down the right field line. Herndon limping over toward the bullpen, can't get to it. Well, watching Herndon run is a study of watching pain in motion.
I asked him about it. He said it doesn't bother him a whole lot, a lot of pain, except when he twists one particular direction, especially when he tries to run sideways. But he does have what they think are chips floating in there, and it bothers him. On and off, he's going to have it scraped when the season is over.
Dickie Knowles, the right-hander, Willie the southpaw, throwing in the Tiger bullpen. Here's the 1-2 pitch, and it's 2-2. Looking for his 14th victory. Ready with a 2-2 pitch. Got him on strike. So he fooled him completely. The second strikeout for Tanana as he floats in that big curve. And the eighth straight batter has been retired by the Detroit southpaw.
Here we see this big curveball starts head high and drops all the way to the knees. Big, slow curveball. Came up from out of nowhere, Cecil. He never had any idea of swinging at that pitch. He gave up on it the minute it was released, and it just dropped from out of nowhere. Normally, when Frank Tanana has pitched this many innings, he has 5 or 6 strikeouts. That's only the second strikeout. Gives you an idea of the control he's had with the curveball, and they've been putting it in play for him.
Jesse Barfield steps up, takes the first pitch in the dirt. That came up and hit McKean.
I think Heath got him.
Well, that could be too.
He tried to short hop the ball, and I believe he came up and look at McKean's not too happy about it at all. I don't know if it was the ball or Mike hanging. Yeah, I think he tries to short hop this ball, and he comes here. We're going to see it and
plunk.
His shoulder and his elbow, and he's got look at the mask fly and the hat.
Here's the pitch, it's low
I'll
for
tell
a
you
ball.
What, you watch Mike Heath long enough to keep you in stitches. He's almost anything can happen when that man's behind the plate.
Or anywhere.
2-0 pitch low, and it is 3 strikes. The ball had caromed over toward the ball boy, and Heath demanded that he return the ball to him. He said, give me the ball. And the ball boy finally gave it to him. He handed it to the umpire, and the umpire threw it back to the ball boy. He may have gotten cut. I'm going to check him out.
now Mike's a doctor. He's a surgeon at work here.
I'll tell you, if I was McKean, I'd get out of there before he starts taking stitches.
Yeah. Well, they call Heath, the players nicknamed him Spike, but I nicknamed him. Yeah, he does have a scrape, I think. I nicknamed him Rocket Man because he's about 30,000 feet in the clouds. About when he lives on a different planet than we do. He's fun to be around.
Here's the pitch from Tanana. He got it over for a strike. It's 3-1. Barfield hit into a double play in the second, walked in the fourth inning. 3-1 pitch. He's hit to right field. Herndon has a long way to come. Luke going out, and Herndon let it get away. He'll have to throw to second, but not in time. A tweener for Jesse Barfield. Herndon was playing very deep, couldn't get there, and made a nice play circling back to keep it from going to the fence. Two-bagger for Jesse Barfield.
Here's one of these bloopers off the end of the bat, not hit very hard, hit high. Larry Herndon playing deep. You almost have to when you have a bad leg. You'd rather come in on a ball than go back. And we see the ball bounce almost over Larry's head. Well, it did get over it, and he made a good play, but it's still an AstroTurf double.
That snaps the string of consecutive batters retired by Tanana at 8. Garth Orge is the batter. And he takes the first pitch outside, ball 1. Tigers lead it 2-0. There's one out in the seventh inning and a runner at second base. Orge is 0 for 2 tonight. And a fly ball to center field. Chet Lemon going over to his left. Barfield halfway goes back to second as Lemon makes the catch and gets it back to the infield quickly. There are two out now, and it'll be up to Manny Lee.
Even though there was one out, and Jesse Barfield played it halfway, when it's obvious that Chet Lemon can catch that ball as deep as Chet was, as a runner, I'd always like to go back to second, tag up, and go to third. Now, if there's an error or a wild pitch pass ball, you can score. And I just believe that Barfield could have made third base there, and there's no reason to go halfway when the ball's easily going to be caught.
Manny Lee is the batter, and a good save by Heath. Jamie Quirk has homered for the Royals. Minnesota leading Kansas City 4-2. Kevin McReynolds is homered for the Mets. New York leads the Pirates 9-2. Here in Toronto, it's 2-0 the Tigers with two out and a runner on, and the pitch is low for a ball. Two balls, no strikes to Manny Lee. The pitch from Tanana is in for a strike at the knee. Barfield is at second base with two out in the bottom of the seventh inning. He fouls it back against the screen, and it's 2-2. Don't forget now, we'll be here at 2:15 tomorrow afternoon, the third game of the series. Walt Terrell and Dave Steeb are the probables. It'll be preceded at 1:45 by the pennant chase here on Pass. Barfield takes the lead. Two out, 2-2 pitch. Right back through the mound, knocked down by Tanana. Whitaker's quick throw, safe. It saved a run. Had it gotten through, Barfield would have scored. Whitaker made it a very close play at first base, but Lee beat it. And Barfield goes to third. So they're at first and third with two out, and Charlie Moore's the batter.
Ball hit. hit on a line. It's right in the middle of the plate, right back at Frank Tanana, and makes a good play to even knock the ball down. It would have surely gone through and scored a run. Lou Whitaker makes a good play here too, but he can't quite get Lee, who can get down that line pretty good.
Not sure what this is all about. Jim McKeon has gone out, and apparently they're asking that Tim McClellan look at the ball. Did. McKeon gives it back to Tanana. I don't know if Charlie was complaining about the ball or whether it was a request from the Toronto dugout. Frank's trying to get Heath's attention.
Number 21.
Tanana wants to throw one pitch.
He's had a couple pretty good blasts come back through there tonight. He has survived them.
Ball may have hit him on the bare hand when he tried to stop it.
Runners at first and third with two out, and Charlie Moore, who banged one off Tanana for a base hit in the third inning, is the hitter. He's one for two tonight. Detroit leads 2-0. Jesse Barfield is at third base. Manny Lee is at first with two out. And the pitch to Moore is high. Toronto loaded the bases in the fourth inning. But Tanana got Orge to hit into a force play. That's Barfield at third. And Manny Lee is over at first. 1-0 pitch is fouled away. 1-1.
Charlie Moore lost his bat. This cold weather, when you put pine tar on your bat, if it's cold like this, you have to continually put some on. It'll get slick on you as the cold. When it's warm, you don't have any trouble with the stick on this stuff, but the cold really makes it get a little shine on it and get slippery, and you can lose the bat, and that's what's happened to a number of the guys tonight.
Ken Kaiser has turned the collar up to protect himself from the breeze that's blowing across his back and shoulders. Runners at first and third, two out, and a 1-1 count to Charlie Moore. That's in for a strike, and it's 1-2 to Moore. Frank has struck out two, walked one. He has allowed five hits in shutting out the Jays thus far through 6 2/3. The 1-2 pitch. Ground ball left side. Fram has it. DeLue, and that's it for the Jays in the seventh. For Toronto, no runs, two hits. No errors, two left. We'll go to the eighth inning. It's Detroit 2 and Toronto nothing. Well, a big howdy from Toronto, Ontario. It's a packed house here at Exhibition Stadium. The signs are out and in force, and the Tiger fans have been rolling in all day long, loading up all of the hotels in the immediate area. We have a delay here. Jim McKeon, who was hit in the chin by a flying elbow by Mike Keith, went in for some attention, and the other three umpires took that opportunity to go in also and do whatever they wanted to do.
Get warm, probably, the way they're hiding in that dugout somewhere. I saw one of them come out and go back, McClellan.
Jimmy Key was going out to warm up, and they just sent him back in, say it's going to be a little bit. Now he has just gone to the mound, and we'll start with his warm-up tosses. Apparently, they're going to change home plate umpires. I imagine that mask is really aggravating that abrasion that Jim McKeon suffered. And that
not very tough if that little abrasion is going to cause him that much consternation.
Kent Kaiser is going to be the new umpire. Jim had an adjective for Jim McKeon, but we won't use it.
Powder puff? No, I wouldn't do that. No.
Well, here's an interesting statistic, or set of statistics, we should say. George Bell and Alan Trammell. the two leading candidates for the most valuable player award. Cram with a decided edge in the average department. Spell in the power and RBIs. Extra base hits. Slugging percentage, not that much difference. On base percentage would give Alan Trammell the edge. Certainly defensive play, you would have to lean toward Alan Trammell.
Oh, you sure would. Alan Trammell is an excellent defensive player. Here we are with hits. Alan has a few more hits. Runs, they're almost even. Walks, Alan has more walks. The strikeouts, he has quite a few fewer strikeouts, but Bell's a heavy swinging home run hitter. Alan has more stolen bases, and game-winning RBIs are just about equal. But in the defense department, there's no doubt Alan Trammell's the superior player, and he's also the leader of the Tiger ball club.
There's some speculation as to just how George Bell's relationship with the news media will affect the voting, if indeed it will affect the balloting. He does not talk with those who cast the ballots, and whether that will have anything to do with the way it is done, only time will tell, and only those who are casting ballots could tell you. This is John Schulock has come out. He is the first umpire to show. Ken Kaiser, we're told, is going to be the new home plate umpire, and he'll have to dig out his gear. It's probably packed away. He's not anticipating using it again after last night in this series. That's Ernie Witt, who did the damage last night. Speaking of damage, there's more at Minnesota, where George Brett has hit a two-run homer, scoring Kevin Seitzer. And now the Royals are leading 5-4. Appreciate that sign from Petoskey. You can't pass up the Tigers, that's a fact. Is that Laurie and Dave? Mitch Webster has homered for Montreal against Philadelphia. The Phillies with a 4-2 lead over the Expos, whose bid to stay in the race in the National League East is slowly dwindling away. The Cardinals had a 3.5 game lead over the Mets starting today's play. Montreal 4 back. Cincinnati 7 games behind the Giants, who have virtually wrapped up the National League West. This man's team, of course, involved in a dogfight with the Jays for the Eastern Division title. And Minnesota looks like it's going to wrap up the West without too much further difficulty with a 6-game lead over Oakland starting today's play. A good opportunity for some of the fans to get some airtime here while the umpires make the switch. Tigers lead it by a score of 2-0. Detroit scored a run in the second inning with one out. Chet Lemon doubled. And Darrell Evans singled him home. It stayed 1-0 until the sixth, when Kirk Gibson led off the inning with the bunt that was thrown wildly down into the Tiger bullpen by Jimmy Key. He went all the way to second. Alan Trammell then followed with a perfectly placed bunt down the third baseline. He beat it out. Gibson went to third. And Larry Herndon drove home the second run for Detroit with a solid single between Manny Lee and Garth Orge to make it 2-0. Here's Ken Kaiser coming back, and it looks like he has all the padding on. Actually, he doesn't need that much padding. He is bigger than a house anyway. Frank Tanana's most precarious predicaments came in the fourth and seventh, a bases loaded situation with two out in the fourth inning, and runners at first and third with two out in the seventh. Well, McKeon's not even coming back, apparently. They're going to work with three umpires. I thought perhaps McKeon worked the base pass, but it's kind of interesting. Not for him. Didn't look like he was that badly injured that he would have to just depart the premises. There's Big Ken Kaiser, who will work behind the plate now for the final two, and John Schulock has gone over to third base, and Tim McClellan will stay at first. So we are down to three. As we start the eighth inning, it'll be Alan Trammell, Larry Herndon, and Chet Lemon against Jimmy Key. Tigers lead it 2-0. First pitch pips to Alan Trammell is low for a ball. Tram is one for two. He had that bunt single in the sixth inning. There's the 1-0 pitch and a fly ball to left center field. Mosby is over, has called for it. And there's one out in the eighth inning. Larry Herndon will bat. He had a run scoring single in the sixth inning. He's one for three. One ball, no strikes to Herndon. Outside, and it's 2-0. Key has struck out three batters, walked one. Has allowed seven Detroit hits. 2-0 pitch to Herndon is in for a strike, 2-1. Two-one pitch from Key is swung on. Foul at the plate. Two balls, two strikes. Key has seven complete games to his credit tonight this season with one shutout. Two-two pitch, foul back on the screen. $46,233 looking in on tonight's game here at Exhibition Stadium. Bouncing ball left side, Manny Lee throws him out, there are two away. That's the second largest crowd of the season. 47,828 were here on July 1st when the Yankees were in town on Canada Day. Chet Lemon will be the batter with two out and nobody on. He doubled in the second and scored the game's first run. He has gone hitless since that at bat. He is one for three. Bouncing ball left side, grabbed by Ort, throw to first, and the Tigers are out in order in the eighth inning. No runs, no hits, no errors, and nobody left. We'll go to the bottom of the eighth. It's still 2-0 Detroit. It's 2-0, the Tigers with a lead as we go to the bottom of the eighth inning, and Detroit will have a new pitcher on the mound. His name is Dickie Knowles, who in his previous appearance faced one batter and picked up a save. That was in Boston. He'll see if he can slam the door and preserve the win for Frank Tanana. Knowles acquired earlier this week from the Chicago Cubs. First pitch delivered to Nelson Liriano, who is batting from the left side now. It'll be Liriano, Mosby, and Benikez. One strike pitch, going away, 1-1. Pat Sheridan is the new right fielder for Detroit, replacing Larry Herndon. There's a pop-up. Brookins has called for it. Tram calls it off. And there's one out in the eighth inning. So Dickie Knowles gets the first man he faces. And now it'll be Lloyd Mosby.
Number 15, Lloyd.
Frank Tanana pitching brilliantly through seven innings. Shut out the Jays on five hits. Allowed just those five hits, striking out two and walked one. Mosby squared but took the pitch inside for a ball. Mosby was safe on an error in the fourth inning. He's 0 for 3 tonight. Lance Mullenix in the on-deck circle will bat for Juan Benikez.
swing and a miss, and it's one and one. A pitch from Knowles, high and away, two balls, one strike. Here's the 2-1 pitch, and a pop foul will be out of play, and it's 2-2. One out, nobody on, bottom of the eighth, Tigers lead 2-0. The pitch from Knowles is hit deep to straightaway center field. Lemon going back at the warning track, has it, and there are two away. Chester had a long run, but it's to the deepest part of the ballpark. And he flagged it down. There are two gone in the eighth inning. It'll be Rance Mullenix.
It's a fastball in the middle part of the plate, just about belt high. Lloyd Mosby drives it very, very deep, dead center field. You can see Chet getting back to the warning track. Wind kills it a little bit. It's easy out.
So Dickie Knowles takes care of the first two, and now he'll face the pinch batter, Rance Mullenix. Mullenix hitting in the DH slot, replacing Juan Beniquez. The pitch from Knowles misses outside, ball one. Mullenix having a fine season, 305 average, 10 homers, 40 RBIs. It's outside. 2-0. Two-0 pitch misses. Three balls, no strikes. George Bell is in the on-deck circle.
Don't want to walk Mullenix and get to Bell. Bell can tie this game up in a hurry. Even if Mullenix hits one out, you have to throw strikes. And he didn't.
Four straight bad pitches to Rance Mullenix. As George Bell, the leading home run hitter, the leading RBI man, will bat for Toronto. Henneman and Hernandez throwing in the bullpen for Detroit. The Tigers lead it. We're going to get a pinch runner for Mullenix now. It is Thornton to run.
Running for Rance Mullenix, number 28, Lou Thornton.
Lou Thornton, the base runner, replacing Rance Mullenix. The Tigers lead it 2-0. The pitch to Bell is a little bit low. That's five straight with which Dickie Knowles has missed. Bell is 1-for-3 tonight. A single to center, a pop up and a ground out. Ground ball left side should close him out. It does. So the Tigers escape in the eighth inning as Knowles comes in and does the job. No runs, no hits. No errors, one left. We'll go to the ninth inning. It's Detroit 2 and Toronto nothing.
You know what I like best about fishing?
Yeah, the catch of the day.
Come on, we'll show you how a good time goes.
For smooth, consistent taste. Now you're talking beer.
A good time's better with a good time beer. And Stroh's is smoking here.
How many ways can Snapper help you this fall?
You can snapperize your leaves, pack and sack them up with ease. It's a snap. Use a twin bag for the chore, bag and wagon, even more. It's a snap. You can clean
snap with a snapper.
See Snapper's full line of products at Pioneer Sales Incorporated in Detroit and Billings Feed Store in Royal Oak.
Now you can have extra cash for whatever reason you need it.
The Discover Card.
Discover Card Cash. Yours three ways. At participating automated tellers. From Discover Card checks. Or at major Sears stores.
Gives you cash.
Because sometimes a little extra cash can go a long way.
The Discover Card.
For people who expect value.
It is 2-0. The Detroit Tigers lead the Toronto Blue Jays as we go to the top of the ninth of game two of this four-game series. The Tigers trying to even it at a game each. Darrell Evans, Tom Brookins, and Mike Keith are the scheduled batters to face this man, Jimmy Key, who has pitched a very strong ball game but trails 2-0. Evans singled home the game's first run in the second inning. He has since gone hitless. He is 1-for-3. First pitch is low, ball one. Tigers with 2 runs, 7 hits, 1 error have stranded 7 runners. The Jays have 0 runs, 5 hits, 1 error. They've left 7 men. Here's the 1-0 pitch. Outside, 2 balls, no strikes. Outfield straight away for Darrell Evans. Ground ball right side. Knocked out, picked up by Liriano, and he throws him out. One away in the Detroit ninth inning, and Tom Brookins will bat.
The third baseman, number 16, Tom Brookins.
We mentioned the 46,233 on hand this evening, the second largest crowd this season and the third largest crowd in history at Exhibition Stadium. The pitch from Key is hit foul and into the seats. One strike to Brookins, who is 0 for 3 this evening. It's up and in. One ball, one strike. There's the Blue Jay himself, located beyond the Toronto dugout. Outside for a ball. 2-1. Get, looks like a relatively new costume for the Blue Jay here. There's a base hit to left field. Brookins with a solid smash. The eighth hit off Jimmy Key. Tigers have a base runner with one out and Mike Keith coming up.
Tom's had some good swings tonight with no results, and here's a belt high pitch right in the middle part of the plate. You can see Tom's head right down over the barrel of the bat. He hits a vicious line drive into left field for a base hit.
Mike Keith had an infield single in the seventh inning. He's 1 for 3. Curveball hangs high and away. One ball, no strikes to Heath. Don't forget, we'll be here at 2:15 tomorrow afternoon on Pass. Walter Terrell and Dave Steeb are the probables. Pennant chase kicks things off at 1:45 on Pass. Here's the 1-0 delivery and another base hit to left field for Heath. Brookins will have to stop at second, and the Tigers put two on with one out of the ninth inning, going to the top of the order. Solid base hits back-to-back by Brookins and Heath. The ninth hit off Jimmy Key.
Here we see Jimmy Key. It's another belt-high pitch on the inside part. Doesn't get in there with enough zip. Mike Heath is right on it and hits another hard line drive into left field. And Jimmy Williams is back out again, and he may make a move this time. He's seen enough. Probably bring in, it's Musselman, isn't it? The left-hander. I believe it is. Lou Whitaker's left-handed, and that's who was warming up before, Musselman and Eichhorn.
8 1/3 innings of work for Jimmy Key tonight. Thus far has allowed a couple of runs, 9 hits, struck out 3 and walked 1. Key gets a well-deserved ovation as he leaves the field. He was just flat-out pitched by his counterpart, Frank Tanana, and leaves trailing 2-0. So there is Jeff Musselman. He'll see if he can get the final outs and keep it at 2-0, going to the bottom of the ninth inning.
Jeff Musselman is 11-4 with a 3.95 earned run average. It's his 65th appearance. He has 3 saves. He's pitched 84 and a third innings, given up 37 earned runs, 5 home runs, walked 49, struck out 50. There's a fastball, curveball, and a slider. He'll be facing Lou Whitaker.
Well, don't forget now, after this series, the Tigers head home. A lot of tickets are available, and good ones for the series against the Baltimore Orioles, which opens on Monday night. Obstructed view and bleacher tickets are available for the 3-game weekend series that opens with the Toronto Blue Jays on Friday the 2nd. You can call 313-963-7300 and charge your tickets to your Visa or MasterCard, or you can come on down to the ballpark and pick them up in person at the advanced ticket office. The Orioles in town for 4, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and then the Jays come in Friday, Saturday, and the season's regular season's finale on Sunday afternoon. Jeff Musselman taking over for Jimmy Key. Last pitched against the Yankees. Was a touch for 2 earned runs in 1 2/3 innings of work.
Lou Whitaker, who had two hits in four at-bats against the starter Jimmy Key, is the hitter with two on and one out in the top of the ninth inning. Brookins at second, and Mike Keith is the runner at first. Pitch is hit to left field again, and Bell is over. He makes the catch. Lewis hit the ball to left or the left side of the infield on all five at-bats. Well, a special welcome to all of you folks from coast to coast in Canada who have been watching the Montreal Expos game on the Sports Network. I'm Larry Osterman along with Jim Northrup at Exhibition Stadium in Toronto, where we're playing in the top of the ninth inning with the Tigers leading by a score of 2-0. The Tigers have two on with two out, and Bill Madlock, who was involved in the controversial play at second base last night, is the batter. He is 0 for 4. Musselman working in relief of Jimmy Key, who pitched brilliantly for the Blue Jays tonight, but didn't get any support as Frank Tanana just outpitched him. Key has just left the game. Musselman coming on here in the top of the ninth with one out and two on, has gotten the first man he's faced, and now is facing Bill Madlock. Tigers have two runs, nine hits, one error. The Blue Jays, no runs, five hits, and one error. Frank Tanana went the first seven for Detroit, and Dickie Knowles came in the eighth inning. Here's the 1-0 pitch that floats in for a strike, 1-1. For the benefit of you folks who have been watching the Expos game, we are working with just three umpires. Ken Kaiser behind the plate after Jim McKeon had taken an elbow in the chin from the Tigers catcher Mike Keith, was forced to leave the game. It was an accident, but it sent McKeon reeling.
Musselman just crossed up Charlie Moore, and Charlie went out to make sure he knows the signs. Somebody either forgot or gave the wrong sign.
Here's the 1-1 pitch, low. Two balls and a strike. The Tigers scored their first run with one out in the second inning. A double by Lemon was followed by a base hit by Darrell Evans. They scored the other run on a bunt, which was turned into a two-base error by Jimmy Key. Another bunt single and a base hit by Herndon. That misses, and it is 3-1. The Blue Jays have had a couple of golden opportunities that Frank Tanana slammed the door on them. They had the bases loaded in the fourth inning, couldn't score, and they left runners at first and third with two out in the seventh inning. Tanana got the final out. Three balls and a strike to count to Musselman. Two on and two out in the top of the ninth. And Madlock draws the base on balls to load him up. Jeff Musselman walks Bill Madlock to load the bases with two out, and Kirk Gibson will be the batter.
The left fielder, number 23, Kirk Gibson.
Here are the Tiger base runners. Tom Brookins is at third. He singled his way on. Mike Keith followed with a base hit to left. He's at second. And Bill Madlock draws the two out, bases on balls. The second walk off Toronto pitching tonight. Pitch from Musselman is low and away. It was Gibson's bunt that started the rally for Detroit in the sixth inning. Jimmy Key fielded it and in his haste threw the ball into the Tiger bullpen, allowing Gibson to go to second. Here's the pitch, and it's looped down the left field line into foul territory. And it looks like it's a pretty good catch in the front row. Gibson broke his bat.
Well, he thumped it over there. He might have broken it hitting it on the AstroTurf.
A lot of broken bats tonight.
Kirk isn't swinging too good tonight. A little bit disgusted with that last swing. He had a pretty good pitch to hit. Didn't do much with it. Let's see. Broke the bat, so he's getting a new one.
Something has just exploded here somewhere, and the lights have gone out. And so is our monitor.
Apparently it's in the booth someplace. I don't know if you heard the explosion behind us. Scoreboard is out also. Tigers have the bases loaded with two out. We're in the top of the ninth. Detroit leads 2-0, and a drive picked off by Lee. So the Tigers are turned away in their bid to add to their 2-0 lead. No runs, two hits, no errors. Two men were left. We'll go to the bottom of the ninth inning. It's Detroit 2 and Toronto nothing. Well, each team has had the golden opportunities to get on the scoreboard, but have been turned away by some clutch pitching tonight. The Tigers have a 2-0 advantage. They had an opportunity to put more up there in the top of the ninth, but left the bases loaded. The Tigers will be back home on Monday night, opening a four-game series with the Baltimore Orioles. We'll televise all four games here on PASS. And then these Toronto Blue Jays come in for the weekend, opening on Friday night. And we'll televise all three here on PASS. A lot of great baseball still in store the regular season here in 1987. It's Dickie Knowles to see if he can take care of the Blue Jays in the bottom of the ninth inning with Cecil Fielder, Jesse Barfield, and Garth Orge, the scheduled batters. There may be some changes. Dickie Knowles came in and pitched the eighth inning for the Detroit Tigers after Frank Tanana had shut out the Jays on five hits through the first seven. Knowles got the first two men he faced, walked. The pinch batter Rance Mullenix, and then got George Bell to ground up.
Tigers have Mike Hanneman and Willie Hernandez warming up in the bullpen. The scoreboard here at the stadium is out.
All of our monitors are out. Fortunately, we have some cameras working. It's 2-0. The Tigers with the lead. And Ernie Witt, who did all the damage last night, will be the pinch batter for Cecil Fielder. Ernie Witt, the man from Mount Clemens. 19 home runs. Leading off the bottom of the ninth inning in a 2-0 Tiger lead. And the first pitch is low for a ball. Here's the 1-0 pitch, 2-0. As Knowles misses high. Witt was 1-for-3 here last night. He had a two-run single in the third inning to tie the ball game. The Jays went on to score four in the third and then hung on for a 4-3 victory. Here's the 2-0 pitch, in for a strike, 2-1. Two-one pitch from Knowles misses, and it's three balls and a strike. Knowles got the first two men he faced in the eighth inning, but then walked the pinch batter, Rance Mullenix, and then got Bell to ground into a forced play. Here's a 3-1 pitch, swung on. Has hit 11 of his 19 home runs here at Exhibition Stadium this season. 3-2 pitch, and it's driven toward right center, racing over Chet Lemon. He's got it! Great catch!
catch by Chet Lemon, who had a terrific jump on the drive and picked it off at the wall. One gone in the ninth inning.
Ball was hit hard and very, very deep. We're going to get a look at it here. Ernie Witt, 3-2, and it's a belt-high fastball up. Ernie Witt hits it hard, doesn't quite pull it enough to get it out of here. Chet Lemon just outruns this ball, makes a fine catch, and runs into the wall. There we see Chet, good speed. Outran the ball, made a good catch.
So there's one gone, and Jesse Barfield will bat. He takes a strike from Knowles. Barfield doubled in the seventh inning. He's 1-for-2, but was stranded at third base. Pitch from Knowles. One ball, one strike. Dickie Knowles, just acquired from the Chicago Cubs earlier this week, picked up the save at Boston in his only previous appearance with the Tigers. Trying for number two here tonight. And it's right back through the middle for a base hit. Barfield with his second hit of the night. First off, Knowles, number six for Toronto. And Orge has been called back. We'll get a runner, batter for him.
Not a bad pitch. It's down in the strike zone, the middle part of the plate, but he hits it hard right between Dickie Knowles' legs. On into center field for a base hit. Rick Leach is going to pinch hit for Garth Ord.
Rick Leach played for the Toronto Blue Jays last night in right field. Went 0-for-2, drew a couple of walks, one of them intentional. He represents the tying run with one out in the bottom of the ninth inning. We're getting part of the scoreboard back in action now after there was an electronic explosion someplace. Too close to where we're located.
Rick Leach is hitting 275, having a pretty good year. Had a good year again for him last year. Was almost out of the game, and he took a chance and went down to winter ball, get himself some exposure, and went to AAA and had a fine year. Sparky's coming out. Willie Hernandez will probably come in here now, but Rick Leach was all but out of baseball, went down, had a good year in AAA, got a chance to come back here with the Jays. He's had two good years for him. He probably will not hit now.
Willie Hernandez coming in. He'll be the third man to work for the Tigers tonight. Frank Tanana is the pitcher of record. Knowles came on in the eighth inning. Now it'll be Willie out of the bullpen. Big crowd of 46,233 has been kind of silent through much of this ball game, but here in the bottom of the ninth, lending some support to the home team. Sparky returns to the dugout now as Willie Hernandez is announced. And we'll see if Jimmy Williams makes a switch in the hitter to come up. So far, Leach is out at the on-deck circle next to Manny Lee. These two teams go after each other again tomorrow afternoon. Walt Terrell and Dave Steeb are the probables, with Doyle Alexander and Jim Clancy closing it out on Sunday.
Willie Hernandez is 3-3 this year with a 3.49 earned run average. It's Willie's 44th appearance. He does have 8 saves. He's pitched 49 innings, given up 19 earned runs, 8 home runs. Walked 19, he struck out 30. Willie throws a fastball, sidearm curveball, and then his out pitch is the screwball.
Willie's last appearance was on Tuesday night at Boston in the Tigers 8-5 victory. He worked one-third of an inning and walked the batter. We talked with Rick Leach about his appearances against his former teammate before the start of today's game.
No, not anymore, because what's happened in the past is over and done with. To be honest about it, I'm just happy for an opportunity to play in the big leagues again. I feel fortunate that I could get together with a team like Toronto that's got an outstanding team, and I feel an outstanding organization that's got a chance to win some games. But as far as any bitter feelings anymore, that's long in the past.
So Rick Leach represents the tying run. Bottom of the ninth inning, one out. Jesse Barfield is at first, and Willie Hernandez is on the mound. And the pitch is tapped into the Blue Jays dugout. One strike. Rick Leach batting for Garth Orge in the bottom of the ninth inning. The pitch from Hernandez hits the right field for a base hit. Barfield is headed for third. Over after the ball is Sheridan, and it's a double. The tying runs are in scoring position. So Rick Leach comes through against the left-hander and drives it to the corner, sending Barfield to third base.
Rick Leach goes out off over that curveball on the out, right in the middle of the plate and up. Willie makes a bad pitch and hangs that curveball. Rick Leach was looking for something off speed, and he just ripped it down the right field line. Puts runners, tying run at second base. They're going to get a base runner for him with one out.
The Kelly Gruber will be the pinch runner for Rick Leach, who does his job. Rick Leach accepting congratulations as he hits the Blue Jays dugout. Tying runs in scoring position with one out, and Manny Lee is the batter. The Tigers lead it 2-0 in the bottom of the ninth. Only one out. Lee had an infield single off Frank Tanana's leg in the seventh inning. He's one for three. Base hit to right field will tie the ball game. Lee heads for second. He may try for three. He will. Sheridan's throw will not be in time. A three-bagger. Game is tied. Stepped in to fill the void left by the injury of Tony Fernandez. Comes through with a clutch hit in the ninth inning and now represents the winning run at third base with one out.
This is the area that concerned the Tigers the most. Here we see Willie Hernandez. Pitch that doesn't do much, stays in the middle of the plate. Manny Lee just slaps at it. He slaps it between first base and the bag and gets it down the line for a triple. Puts the winning run on third with one out, and that's going to be it for Willie.
Mike Kenneman is coming in from the Tiger bullpen as the Tigers have let one get away from them late here at Exhibition Stadium. Frank Tanana pitched brilliantly through seven. Dickie Knowles faced four men in the eighth with no damage, but in the ninth inning, the Blue Jays have been nothing but trouble. As Blitt started the inning with a fly deep to center field that Chet Lemon outran and caught at the wall. Barfield followed with a single. And then Rick Leach doubled down the line. Manny Lee followed with a two-run double to tie the ball game, and there's still just one out. And the winning run is at third base. What had been a quiet, sedate crowd at Exhibition Stadium, a crowd of 46,000, is now on its feet. A critical turn of events here in the bottom of the ninth inning as these two teams look toward the Eastern Division title.
This is the area that had the Tigers worried the most was the bullpen, and tonight it fails them again. Mike Henneman is 9-2 with a 2.87 earned run average. It's Mike's 51st appearance. He has six saves. He's pitched 87 and two-thirds innings. He's given up 28 earned runs. 7 home runs. He's walked 26 and struck out 69. Mike throws a hard sinking fastball, slider, and a forkball, or split-fingered fastball. When he's on, he's very tough with that split-fingered pitch to get it over. Tough to right-hand hitters. Charlie Moore won't hit.
Willie Upshaw has come out, and he'll be the pinch batter. Manny Lee, the man that they said would replace Fernandez with a glove but not with a bat, has done it all tonight. He has been flawless with a glove and dynamite with a bat. He has 2 hits, including the double that has tied the game in the bottom of the ninth, and he carries with him the tying run. They will put Upshaw on base.
They probably will walk the bases loaded and pitch to Lloyd Mosby and either go for the play at home plate or for a double play.
Upshaw takes the intentional walk to first. Sparky looking on from the dugout as Nelson Liriano comes up. Danny Lee carries the game winner. He's at third base.
You can see Sparky indicate they're gonna put Nelson on too, so that you have a play at every base. You have a double play opportunity. The umpires have got to move into position here. They're calling timeout. To them, they can throw somebody out at home. It'll have to be very close to throw out Manny Lee.
So the bases are loaded. One out. Game is tied at 2-2. And Lloyd Mosby is the batter. Manny Lee carries the game winner at third. Here's the way the Tigers are set defensively. The outfield is in. The infield at double play depth when Trammell returns and Evans goes back to first base. Pitch is inside to Mosby. One ball, no strikes. Ooh, big save by Mike Keith. 2-0. Many are standing here at Exhibition Stadium as the Blue Jays have scored 2 in the bottom of the ninth to tie it. And they have the bases loaded with 1 out in a bid to win it. The 2-0 pitch, ground ball right side, loose, headed for home. He gets through, it got away, and Toronto wins. steal one away from the Tigers. It could be a crushing blow to the Detroit hopes of winning an American League East title. Lou Whitaker threw to the plate. It was there in time, but it skipped away from Mike Heath as the Tigers went for the force play. And Toronto's Manny Lee scored the game winner as the Jays score three in the bottom of the ninth to win it 3-2.
Boy, that was surprising. That was a one-hopper, and Lou Whitaker hit like a shot. It looked like an easy double play over to Trammell to first base. Lou chose to come home and threw the ball away. They're playing in double play depth. I don't know what Lou was thinking, Ed. Mosby does run good, but you can see this ball is a shot right to Lou Whitaker. And he could have, they were playing in middle double play depth, and he throws it home and throws the ball short, throws it away. That's the end of the ball game. Well, I got to believe he goes to Trammell to first. That's an easy double play.
That's the way it looked, but that's not the way it was. And it is a 3-2 Toronto victory.
Here we see Lou making the throw, and he short hops Heath. Nothing much Heath can do. He tried to block it and catch it. Took a hop up, hit him in the chest, and away it goes. Game.
A tremendous comeback for the Blue Jays as they take advantage of what has been kind of a shaky situation in the bullpen for the Tigers down the stretch. And they tag the Tigers with a 3-2 loss, and they go in front by 2.5 games, which is the largest lead any team has held since the 5th of August. In the ninth, three runs, three hits. Three were left. It is a 3-2 final. Toronto, we'll be back with a wrap-up in just a moment here on Fast.
Pro-Am Sports coverage of Major League Baseball has been brought to you by Stroh's and Strohlite. Now you're talking good times, and Stroh's is spoken here. By True Value Hardware. More than just a name, it's their way of doing business. By Highland. Nobody but nobody sells for less. And by Builder Square, where you're guaranteed the lowest prices on home improvement every day. Now 6 convenient Detroit locations.
All right, time to call it a day.
That's not what I had in mind.
Come on, we'll show you how a good time goes. We're going to a place where they talk Stroh's. Cause a good time's better with a good time beer. And Stroh's is smoking here.
Here's how the good times get better. Stroh's and Strohlite 15 and 30 packs. A convenient package at a special value. Get them wherever you buy your beer.
Stroh's is smoking here.
Commitment, experience, it all comes together when you work with the best. Master Mechanic Tools, only from True Value Hardware Stores. At the Indianapolis Speedway, or in your own garage, they're backed by True Value Hardware Stores' commitment, experience, and exclusive customer satisfaction policy. Master Mechanic Tools, exclusively from True Value Hardware Stores and Home Center.
I wish I had a chainsaw, a really good one, like a McCullough with a 20-inch laminated tip, a 3.7 cubic inch engine, electronic ignition, and vibration-free design.
You can get your McCullough 20-inch chainsaw at Builder Square for just $219 after manufacturer's $50 mail-in rebate.
This is great! Now, can we talk about that yacht I've always wanted?
Builder Square. The more we sell, the lower the price. The lower the price, the more we sell.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's Highland's anniversary, and to celebrate, we thought we'd give all employees the week off. Yay! But on second thought, we decided to do something great for our customers, so we're going to give them a sale.
Save on this White Westinghouse 2-hour timed electric dryer with upfront lint filter, just $187.
Of course, with savings like these, the stores will be mobbed, so we'll have to work extra hard. Sound great, Hackett?
Yippee.
The Highland Superstore's anniversary sale.
Here are the totals for tonight's game. Toronto, 3 runs, 8 hits, 1 error, 10 left. The Tigers, 2 runs, 9 hits, 2 errors, 9 left. Tanana, the starter, his record is 13-10. Going in, and Knowles came on in the 8th. Hernandez in the 9th is the loser. His record is now 3-4, and Henneman in the 9th inning. Jimmy Key, the starter, Musselman coming on in the ninth inning, picks up the save, his victory. His record is now 12-4. 46,233 were here to watch an incredible comeback by the Toronto Blue Jays. Well, tonight's Soft Cloth Boys player of the game is Frank Tanana, who did a whale of a job and deserved a victory here tonight, but came away empty-handed. He worked seven innings, shut them out on five hits, struck out two, walked one. Did a good job, but no victory for Frank Tanana on this night. Our congratulations to Frank Tanana, our Soft Cloth Boys player of the game. And don't forget, when you're looking for an outstanding car wash, look for the sign of one of the 23 Metro Detroit area Soft Cloth Boys. 3-2 the final. The Toronto Blue Jays prevail. We'll take a look at the standings now and see that the Jays have moved in front by 2.5 games as we head into the final days of this season. Milwaukee 9.5 back, followed by New York, Boston, Baltimore, and Cleveland. A crushing loss for the Tigers tonight. Now they must come back and pick up a couple of victories before heading out of here. 3-2 the final. We'll be back with the wrap-up on tonight's game in just a moment, including the key moment.
Shopping. Mom and I used to spend hours at the store. She took me with her every week. I think I was in training. Look, shopping's okay, but it takes time, something I don't seem to have a lot of. So I go where I can get it done fast. I've got other things to do.
Do I let my accounting department get in over its head?
Only at the pool.
Do I expect my bookkeepers to cancel vacations when we're snowed?
Never.
Do I draw a blank when my DP goes AWOL? Not on your month-end accruals.
Blue Jays win 3-2 to take the second game of this four-game series. The key moment of tonight's game came in the ninth inning. Manny Lee had doubled home two runs. The Tigers had walked two to load the bases, and with one out, Lloyd Mosby came to the plate.